Might as well transition to this to make sure I have everything set up. Hi. I have no idea what I'm doing, but I haven't made everything go boom yet, so we'll see. Ah. Hi, the life of Mal. Can you hear me? Have I set things up correctly? Watch this be just entirely me giving you a personalized history lesson, which, to be fair, would still be amusing. I don't have anything better to do. Apologies if the sound is shit. I decided I didn't want to use my very clunky headphones, and it's really hot, so I have to have a fan going. So, right now we're just awkwardly chilling as we see if anyone else is going to come and watch. Cool, thank you. I think I technically have a Twitter, but I don't use it. I posted a link on a bunch of other sites I have, but it remains to be seen if anyone will access that. Yeah, I decided to go full in on this. If you look down below, you'll see I even set up a little Google Classroom because it amused me. And hey, chance to practice my Google Classroom abilities. There's currently, like, nothing there. But yeah, I figured, set the announcement about 11:05, I'll give the link. Oh, thank you, Hitsusan9. Thank you for coming from Jeff's Discord. Checking my other thing to make sure that I actually have everything running. But yes, hello, I am actual history teacher, as in I have a credential and everything. I'm legitimately, so credential is basically your state going, yes, this person. Oh, that is a good point. I think I forgot to put a link in Hannah and Jake's Discord. Mostly because, unlike Jeff's Discord, they do not have a specific spot for, like, self-promotion. Oh, I've seen their masks! Oh, I've seen their masks in the Discord. I really, really want one. Their mask looks so cool. My mask, I mean, I don't really need a mask right now for reasons that I'll get into in a second. But, I really want one of their masks. There we go. I'm actually surprised my computer has not completely just given out yet, because I'm running all of this off of a laptop that is not a very good one. I decided to join Jake and Hannah's Discord mostly because I was really bored. So, little intro. I'm an actual California history teacher. California, like I think most states, you have to get credentialed in order to teach in a public school. Credential is pretty much them going, you are good, you can teach. You can teach without a credential, but you have to go through extra hoops. So I got my cleared credential. When you first get a credential, it takes like 2 years of actually teaching before they go, yeah, you're really all right. You sort of have like a preliminary. I got my cleared credential, and around the time I got my cleared credential, the school I was teaching at said that they didn't need me back. Basically because they, yeah, I know, Jake has a Sunday service, so probably some people watch that instead, but what the hell. So the school that I was at teaching at the past year didn't want me back because they wanted to combine a history teacher and an English teacher because it's a small school. So currently I am an unemployed history teacher, and I like teaching history, and I was bored. So I decided, what the hell, let's do a history stream. And Life of Mal convinced me, not that it took much convincing. So right now, I'm going to drop in, it's going to work very odd because we only have two people, so we'll probably just, if you have different choices, I'll just go with whatever one I like best. But I'm dropping in the chat a link to the poll that I've got for what the heck our lesson will be about. Yay, things working. So basically what these are, I'll run through them for you. All of these are lessons that I have actually taught to kids, high schoolers. Anything that is U.S. history is at least a year old. Anything that's world history is more up to date. These are ones that I have completely full. I'm not surprised that was the vote. The JFK one's actually a short one, so depending if people are interested, we might be able to do that and then do another. But, yeah, so civil rights overview, these overview ones are going to be big. This is a game-ish. It's sort of, I did a poll earlier, but, yeah, so those are the options for what we're going to learn about. And probably get aware about that. when I say main causes, it's World War I, actually. If you look, it's a little hard to tell from that. Main causes of World War I is a... I'm forgetting the word. I don't think it's acronym, but it's a mnemonic, maybe it's the right word, that we use to help kids remember what were the main causes. So what were... treaties are part of it, but there's several different elements that build together for that. Okay, so I think what we're going to do, because I think this will work out, the JFK assassination, if I'm remembering correctly, is not very long. It's going to be even shorter because I chopped out some sections of this, which would require, like, now students all read this together. So we can probably do both of them. So one moment while I try and get everything set up, and in a second we will, I'm going to change the title of the stream as well. We're going to start learning about the JFK assassination in a moment. Watch me probably spell things wrong. Yeah, definitely. That's not spelled right, but do I care? Not really. Okay. Yeah, I was going to see if I could add, like, background music like Hannah has, but then I was like, I've already taught myself a whole new streaming software in about an hour last night, so let's just do that. Come on, computer. Also, at some point, more than likely, there will be a cat, because I have a cat, and he is being, he heard me talking about him, he's being remarkably not horrible. sorry, my computer / OBS is being a bit of a jerk. And there we go. Sorry guys, thought I had the filter set up, have to modify the filter slightly. I'm using, I'm using Google Slides just because that's what I have things saved in, and I had to, like, modify things. So I've got doing repairs on the fly. Still surprised everything hasn't crashed and burned yet. Okay. Think that's good? His name is Methos. That is M-E-T-H-O-S. He is named after a character from Highlander, the TV show, which I highly recommend, both because the history is actually pretty decent. It has a lot of flashbacks to various historical periods, and they do a pretty decent job of, you know, on a TV show budget, making things look good. I also really recommend it because every single episode has a sword fight, and the sword fights are all amazing. Also recommend it because the character Methos and the main character Duncan are totally gay for each other. I will accept no arguments on this. It is all but canon. So, I think I've got everything set up. There we go. Let me just get chat to where I can actually see it. So, JFK assassination. Usually when I'd be giving this lecture, it'd be for this section of the lesson. Again, all these lessons have been kind of modified to be a little bit more lecture-y. If you have questions, drop them in the chat. I will do my best to answer them. Since I am a history teacher, specifically a high school history teacher, my knowledge is a bit more general, but I tend to have a lot of random knowledge floating around. Usually if I gave this lecture, it would be part of an ongoing series. So before this, we would have talked about civil rights movement stuff. We would have talked about, you know, JFK's election, various things like that. We're going to drop in right at kind of the stuff that everyone knows about. So, 1963. We are in 1963, the fall of 1963, when people are going back to school because in 1963 there was no COVID keeping us all homebound. In the fall of 1963, President Kennedy is widely popular. I'm probably being a little bit kind of hyperbolic. I don't know if that's the right word or even a word, but Kennedy is like one of the most popular presidents of all time, both like when he was actually president and even now, even knowing some of the messed up stuff like that he, you know, I don't know the specific numbers for how many mistresses he probably had, but Kennedy's just widely popular. He's, you know, young. He's considered, you know, amazingly handsome. I mean, I don't think he's super handsome, but he is, like, one of probably the most handsome president we've had. And his family is just, you know, national celebrities. Like, nowadays, we look at Trump and, full disclosure, I freaking hate Trump. Should not be surprising given the circles I hang out in online. But looking at it now, you know, Trump, we're just kind of, when we talk about his family, we're joking about them. You know, all the jokes around about his inauguration where it was like, blink twice if you're being held captive for Melinda Trump. Is that his wife? I don't really care that much. But Kennedy's family was just like wildly popular. His wife, Jackie, super, super popular, considered this, like, icon of society. They have this, their family is called, like, Camelot. Their family and their sort of home life is referred to as Camelot. So they are these huge, huge figures that are seen as just amazing. So, 1963. Kennedy's really popular. Kennedy is also coming up on an election. So one of the big things he's doing is he is a sitting president who is starting to move toward, hey, elect me again. So super, super popular. He's traveling around going, hello, I am popular. Please vote for me again. So going around to all the various different, you know, parts of the city. Specifically, November 22nd, 1963, Kennedy is going to Dallas, Texas. Specifically, he's going there because the Texas Democratic Party is in an uproar. And I'm blanking on the specifics of it. I want to say that this is connected to the division between Northern and Southern Democrats. This is right around the time, again, sort of, a lot of this is simplifying because, again, high school, you simplify stuff. But this is around the time where there's that switch in Democrats and Republicans. And specifically, it's kind of in the middle of that switch. So going back a moment, the position of Democrat and Republican, along with the name, have sort of weaved in and out over the years. Maybe at some future point, if I keep doing this, I'll do a more in-depth dive about that. For a lot of the civil rights movement, there's this harsh divide between Democrats in the North slash West, as in like California kind of West is what I mean by that, and Democrats in the South. Democrats in the South, horrible racist assholes. Again, generalizing, but I'm on Twitch. I don't have to be like super politically correct about all of this. So Texas Democrat Party has a bit of an issue because they're kind of right in the middle of that. So Kennedy's going to Dallas. He is Southern strategy. Ooh, that's a good question, Life of Mal, because that is ringing a bell, but it's a lot of this is sort of one of the problems with doing kind of this is I'm used to giving lessons where I'd have kind of prepped for this because, you know, it's coming in resource. I think Southern strategy is referring to trying to get the African-American vote for Democrats, but I might be wrong. I'll look into that for some future thing. Oh no, racism. Yeah, racism is annoying. So Kennedy is, when you're the president, you're kind of unofficially the head of your party. So even though Trump is an idiot, because Trump is the sitting Republican president, he's the president, he's Republican, he's semi-officially the head of the party. So the same thing is happening for Kennedy. He's not literally the head of the Democratic Party. I think the Democratic Party actually has like a specific position that is that. But when you are the highest elected office of your party, you're the face of that party. So you're being going to be called around to sort of, you know, soothe over the aches. That's what he's doing. So Kennedy is really popular. He's going to Texas to use that popularity to raise the popularity of the Texas Democratic Party. And he's going to Texas as part of this, I'm going to be up for election soon, please vote for me. So, as with most things, the president very rarely does something without stuff being planned. More so in the past than currently, especially because, you know, now it's easier to travel. But this trip to Dallas, Texas, and there were multiple other stops along the way. It wasn't like Dallas to Washington and back again. The trip had been announced in September. It had been planned. Everyone knew it was going on. Despite the fact that Kennedy was really popular, they had expected that they wouldn't be greeted too warmly in Texas. Because Texas, unsurprisingly, is largely conservative and Republican. And while Kennedy wasn't too liberal, he's still pretty liberal. As things go. One thing worth remembering is Kennedy was pretty much the first Catholic president. I don't even know if there's still been one because religion in that way is a little bit less, but the fact that Kennedy was a Catholic was actually this huge barrier for his family getting into politics because America's racist. America also has a history of not trusting the Catholic Church. Like from way back, there was a lot of like scandals about like, there's a big history of scandals of various places going, oh no, these Catholic nunneries have been like basically doing sexual slavery, which mostly was not true. There's some elements of truth to it. Again, topic for another day. So everyone expects, yeah, America doesn't like anyone that isn't a WASP. Yes. And Kennedy was not a WASP. He was WASP adjacent because he basically has everything WASP except for the religion. And the fact that he was able to become president is a big deal because people were saying like, we can't elect Kennedy president. He'll listen to the Pope. He won't listen to the American people. The Pope will tell him what to do and he'll do it. Didn't end up happening. I'm not sure. I'd be interested in reading some more about how personally religious Kennedy was, as opposed to, you know, just because everyone, I think everyone, you know, sort of understands that if there's like your religion and then how much you actually practice that religion. So going to specifically Dallas, they're expecting like, oh, hello, Mr. President, polite golf claps. Instead, they get a completely packed airport. When they land, you know, they land in US 1 or whatever the heck the president's plane is. The airport's just mobbed. There's people like pressing up against the gates at the edges of the runway. They'd part of that plan that they'd had, you know, when the trip was announced, was a motorcade, so parade, procession through the city. Streets are lined. So this looks good for Kennedy, because Kennedy's like, cool, I'm wildly popular, even in a place where, you know, because it's sort of against me politically, I should not be popular. Cough all through this. So John and Jacqueline, aka Jackie Kennedy, his wife, get into an open-air limousine. This is something that would not happen nowadays because of what's about to happen in Dallas. But yeah, open-air convertible limousine. They did have a kind of protective bubble they could put over the limousine, but it was a little bit more intended for, like, rain. It was kind of like this. I don't know if they actually had, like, I'm assuming it was actually a convertible, but they had the option to put on the bubble, but it's Texas, so I don't know how hot it was, but I'm pretty sure it was hot. And also, Kennedy's this really big, larger-than-life figure. He likes to be like, hello, I can't do a Kennedy impression. I am Kennedy, you know. Hello, everybody. So, got our limo. There's a few limos in this motorcade convoy. We have Kennedy. We have his wife. Then right here is the governor of Texas, John Connally, and hidden by the little roof latch thing here is his wife. So president of the United States, wife of the president, governor of Texas, governor's wife, Secret Service dudes. They're headed specifically for the Dallas Market Center for a meeting with civic and business leaders. So shaking hands, you know, again, publicity tour. He's there to make people happy. He's there to make people, you know, like him. The route is not direct. I don't know about that, Hinson. I feel like I've heard that before, that the first armored presidential vehicle was Al Capone's car. It sounds weird enough to be true, but I don't know specifically. So they're heading from the airport, and in a few slides I'll have a route. The route is not direct. It's not book it there as fast as possible. It's let's go through the city so I can wave at people so that I can be, you know, so people can go, look, son, it's our president. Wave at him. You can tell your grandkids you waved at Kennedy. Yeah. I don't know. I'm in a weird mood. So here's the map of the motorcade. So again, motorcade parade, as it was shown in the papers. So Love Field is the airport. They're going to wind their way through the city and then to the trademark. Here it is on a more recent Google map. So again, they're kind of going right through what I assume to be downtown. I don't think I've ever gone to Dallas, but again, big, big, like, we're going to be seeing everyone, like, vote for me, everybody. And again, this is published in newspapers. There's, you know, signs along the way. Everyone's like, ooh, president's coming to town. And this is, you know, still in a time where that has a little bit more meaning, I think, than it does now. Not just because of the difference in popularity between Kennedy and Trump, but you have to remember, you know, this is the 60s. This is, yeah, TV's a thing, but it's not as big a thing. It's starting to become a bigger thing, but this is still like, oh, we can go see them in person. And I can kind of get that, you know, if someone else was president, I'd be interested in seeing them if they came to town. Given who currently is president, the only reason I'd be interested is if I could, like, throw tomatoes or something at them. So they're headed through. And sadly, one of the things is the governor's wife. So again, remember that the governor of Texas and his wife are riding with them. They're going through these just completely packed streets. You know, there's people lining the streets. There's people up in the buildings. And the governor's wife's like, Mr. President, you can't say that Dallas doesn't love you. No, you certainly can't, Kennedy responds. At 12:30 p.m., the motorcade enters Dealey Plaza. and passes by this building here, which is the Texas School Book Depository. What that is it's quite literally a place where Texas keeps its school books. I don't know if they had this at the time, but Texas currently has a law or something like that in place where every, I want to say it's 5 years, it might be less, by law, like every kid in Texas gets a new set of school books. So Texas is a big state because it has that population and because of its law of renewal of textbooks. It's a really big market state for textbooks. So if you're into the sort of evolution side of things, so if you've watched, like I know Amun-Ra, I think, has made some videos about it, Texas has a stupid big grip on what's in textbooks. A lot of textbooks manufacturers, because if they can sell their book to Texas, they've made a profit, they will write their book to the Texas state standards. And then depending on how big your state is, you might get the Texas standards. So for example, I've got this sort of secondhand, is California textbooks start off as Texas textbooks, which are then rewritten to match the California standards. State standards are basically a list of what needs to be in your curriculum. So for example, if you look, it's actually here in this directions, there we go, where it says follow me, that Tumblr that I run is a history Tumblr, and it actually has all of the California state standards listed out. So it's all these things that say you have to teach about this. So a lot of times you can have like bad standards and good instruction, but you're more likely to have good instruction, I think, if your standards are good. So for example, California has a standard which mandates the teaching of LGBTQ issues. California has part of their history standard is that you have to teach about the Holocaust. And if you don't hit those, you're in trouble, basically. So important. Diversion. Anyway, so basically this building is a big a big warehouse. So there's a lot of books in there that are, you know, before they get sent out to schools or something like that. As the motorcade passes by the Texas School Book Depository, 3 shots are fired. 1 shot misses completely. 1 shot hits JFK in the base of the back of his neck and goes on to hit Governor Connally. When we get to the conspiracy theories, this bullet is the one that is referred to as the magic bullet. It is not really magic. I'll tell you about that when we get to the conspiracy theories. And 1 shot hits the back of JFK's head. So 3 shots fired. 1 shot misses completely. I think they later find it in like a curb or something. 2 shots hit Kennedy. So I've seen some medical stuff, and I think I'll talk about that in a later slide, but pretty much from what I've seen, he could have maybe survived this one. He could not have survived that one. And again, we're going to run through kind of the general facts, and then we'll kind of backtrack to go into the conspiracies. So mass pandemonium starts off. Yeah, and the shots are not as impressive. We'll get into that in a little bit. So first shot, kind of people don't know what's going on because they did. Sorry, going back a slide. This is the order of the shots, too. So first shot misses. Other 2 shots hit. When this shot misses, there's a little bit of confusion because, sir, you can see in some of these clips that he's got his motorcade. There's another one behind, I think, LBJ, so the vice president, who would eventually become president, isn't that one, but I'm blanking out if he was. There's, you know, cops all around them. It's a motorcade. So when the first shot misses, there's some confusion. Because some people are going, holy shit, that was a bullet. Some people are going, did someone set off a firecracker, or was that some other noise? Even Governor Connally, I think there's an interview with him where he says, you know, when I was hit, I didn't realize until much later. But when the shot hits the back of Kennedy's head, everyone knows what's going on. And we'll look at, there's actually footage of that shot hitting that we're going to look at in a little bit. So almost very quickly after that last shot hits, people know shit's going down. So all around, people are, you know, falling to the ground because, hey, there's bullets going off everywhere. And the motorcade races to the nearest hospital, which is a place called Parkland Hospital. when JFK arrives at the hospital, he's DOA, basically. He's dead on arrival. He's moribund. He has no chance of survival. I think they sort of semi-artificially keep him alive for a given definition of that until a priest can be called. But he's pronounced dead at 1 p.m. So motorcade entered the plaza at 12:30. By 1 p.m., he's pronounced dead. So he has died in Dallas. 30 minutes later, an announcement is made to the press, because of course there's press gathered. There were already press with them, because, you know, anytime the president does anything, it's newsworthy. But more press had gathered once it was, oh, JFK has been admitted to the hospital. And at 2 p.m., JFK's body is taken out of Parkland Hospital and onto Air Force One. Interesting side note, this is technically illegal. Technically, his body is supposed to stay in Dallas, Texas, while, you know, an investigation of a crime is committed. But essentially, the Secret Service go, like, yeah, no, that's the president, we're taking him with us. So, his body is just very quickly, like, they got sorry. My thoughts got away from me. My computer is not happy. Sorry guys, my computer did a little weird thing. Am I still good? Can I just get compo in the chat that I'm still good because my computer doesn't like me? I like that it's in the, yeah. Yeah, we have two jobs, stop counterfeiters and protect the president, so give us the body. That is a very good, that is a very good point. Thanks. Sorry, my... as I said, like, my computer, I literally just have, like, a laptop that is about 3 years old, maybe, at this point, so it looked like it froze up on my end, and I wasn't sure if it did or not. Okay, so, technically, they illegally take the body. I don't think anyone ever made a fuss about that, or if they did make a fuss, it was just like a wait, no, don't. But so they're taking the body. Basically, the one of the big reasons for this is the president is dead. That's something that even though we have kind of prepped for that in the Constitution, it's happened so rarely that every time it happens is understandably a big freaking deal. They take his body to Air Force One, and I think they take off immediately. Now I'm beginning to doubt if they take off immediately or not. But so president dies, is pronounced dead at 1 p.m. By 2:38 p.m., the vice president, Lyndon B. Johnson, is sworn in as the 36th president of the United States. He is sworn in on Air Force One while Kennedy's body in its coffin is in like a little back, like a sort of, I don't know if it was a bedroom, but like a little back room. And I'll have an image of that in a second. Oh, there we go. That answers my question because I'd forgotten off the top of my head. Air Force One, so it had been parked on the tarmac at the airport. They bring the president on board. They bring the vice president on board. They swear the vice president in as president, and they take off. You also have to remember, and this will feed into some of the conspiracy theories, this is taking place during the Cold War. You know, JFK, huge player in the Cold War. If you vaguely remember, you know, Bay of Pigs incident, Cuban Missile Crisis, this is, I don't think it's really at like the height of the Cold War, but it's a big part of the Cold War. And one of the biggest superpowers on Earth is briefly, at least, without a leader. So Air Force One takes off, you know, get the president home. We'll figure shit out later. When they get back to Washington, D.C., JFK's body is transported to the Bethesda Naval Hospital for an autopsy. So there was not an autopsy performed in Dallas, pretty much. In Dallas, they just went, this man is dead. put him in a coffin, sent him off. So this here is really, really famous image of Lyndon B. Johnson being sworn in. Interesting fact, he's supposed to be sworn in on a Bible, because that's, you know, how we swear in presidents, is we have them put their hand on a Bible and swear in. Sort of accidentally, he was sworn in on like a, I'm forgetting the specific term for it, but it's like a book of prayers for Catholics. So it's like a devotional or daily or something like that, basically because it was the one they could find. So he is being sworn in Air Force One. You can tell that it's in an airplane. I don't know if it's back here or if it's in front of the camera, but there's a little side room, which is where JFK's body in that coffin is being laid. Right next to LBJ as he's sworn in is Kennedy's wife. A thing to note, and probably the reason why I'm pretty sure there's a color version of this out there somewhere, but you will like never see a color version of this photo, because if we look from another angle, this is later on when the plane arrived in D.C. Kennedy's brother is there as his wife gets off the plane. That right there, that's Kennedy's blood. She had her husband's blood on her pink dress. So that's one of those, like, you'll see a lot of, you'll see color photos from before Kennedy was shot or from certain angles. I don't think I've ever seen a color version of either one of these two photos, and I'm pretty sure the reason is that's blood. It's very obvious in this one, even though it's black and white, it'd be even more obvious in a colored image. So they take JFK off. On November 24th, his body is laid in state, so, you know, big public flashy funeral. The public are allowed to view the casket. It is a closed casket ceremony. On November 25th, a funeral mass is held at St. Matthew's Cathedral, and Kennedy is eventually laid to rest at Arlington National Cemetery. Pretty much the reason behind that is, remember that he had served in World War II as in the Navy. So he was on a torpedo boat? I'm not a big military historian, but yeah. So he's laid in Arlington National Cemetery. Sort of the reason he's allowed to be laid there is because he's a military dude. Interesting thing is that he'd actually been there before. So 2 weeks before, like exactly 2 weeks before Kennedy's buried in Arlington National Cemetery, he had been there for Veterans Day. But like happens for pretty much all presidents, he gets the big flashy funeral. So he gets, you know, the big viewing with people like waiting in line for days. I think like at the end before they, like the day, but you know, they like kept the viewing open longer than they planned because so many people wanted to see him. He gets the big, you know, military funeral with all the, you know, the honors and everything that America can give, and laid to rest. And this is a more recent version of his tomb. It was redone a few times. Like the first time, it didn't kind of look nearly as impressive. It has an eternal flame, so you know, always burning flame. If it goes out, there's a mechanism for it to be reignited. And let's see if my video will work that I've got. The most famous moment of the funeral is surrounding Kennedy's children, because Kennedy has, you know, small children. He's got John was his son. And of course, it doesn't want me to play the video. I'm not going to bother trying to play that because I don't want to fiddle with that. But the most famous moment of the funeral is, if I go back, let me just look at the image. There we go. The most famous moment of the funeral is Kennedy's wife is standing there with her daughter and her son by her side. And basically her son was kind of too young to know what the heck was going on. So he essentially goes like, you know, what's happening? Why is daddy in the coffin? And they go, salute your father. So John gives a salute to his father, which is the big moment of every one of these. So president is dead. We've handled the transfer of power. We have LBJ going into office. We have LBJ assuming the role of president. One of the things he's got to do, he's got to figure out what the heck happened to JFK. So on November 29th, 1963, LBJ orders a committee be formed to investigate the assassination. So the Warren Report is the big book that comes out of this. The Warren Commission, which I believe was named after the guy who founded it. Yes, there we go. So officially, it's called the President's Commission on the Assassination of President Kennedy. But unofficially, everyone refers to this as the Warren Commission or the Warren Report, because the leader of the group charged with this is Chief Justice Earl Warren, so named after the guy that helms it. Eventually, the commission will publish an 888-page report with 26 volumes of supporting documents. So, like, this is the complete Warren Report. Like, I think this one in the front here is the actual here's what happened. These are all, like, the sources. Basically, this is going source, please. This is including all of the sources. It's a big, big book. I will guarantee you that most people who believe in conspiracy theories about the Kennedy assassination have not read it. Part of this was that for a long time it was kind of hard to get a copy of. It's a big, chunky book. They made several copies, but they're in, like, sort of big libraries. And, you know, because there's not that many copies of it for a long time, like, you know, it was, you couldn't check it out of the library, stuff like that. Excuse me. But part of the Warren Report is who the heck's responsible. So these are the official findings of the Warren Report. We'll go into the conspiracy theories in a little bit. The released version. I don't think I've read the released version. I'll talk about what I have read when we get to the conspiracy theory section. But yeah, it's really dry because it's an official document. The Warren Report, going back, they're not making this to be sold. This is an official, like, court documents. And, you know, with some rare exceptions, if you read court documents, they are so goddamn dry. Side note, I've been on a jury before. A few years ago, I was on a jury. It was a domestic abuse case. And while it was fascinating, and one of the reasons I wanted to be on the jury is because, you know, it feeds into the history of, in California, American government is under the history umbrella, so I can teach American government classes with my shiny credential. But so much of being on a jury is just, like, trying not to fall asleep, which was extra hard for me because at the time I was working night shift, but super freaking dry. You can find now, I keep meaning to get my hands on one. There have been a few that, like, they've taken the Warren Report and kind of spiced it up a bit. But the problem you run in with stuff like that is that you're probably going to get a version that was edited by a conspiracy theorist and thus is kind of useless. So, Warren Commission's official findings. The assassin, the man who killed John F. Kennedy, is this dude, Lee Harvey Oswald. He's an interesting guy. Like, his... Yeah, same thing. Any official report, yeah. Any official report. Warren Report, 9/11, any official report is going to be really freaking dry. It's like reading primary sources. You know, primary sources are usually really freaking dry. It's, you know, this sort of secondary stuff that you get fun with. So, Lee Harvey Oswald had joined the U.S. Marine Corps at age 17 in 1956. In December, so when he joined the U.S. Marine Corps, he had to take a shooting test, you know, to see how good of a sharpshooter he was. So in December of 1956, he scored a 212 on a shooting test. This officially made him a sharpshooter. So he was not, to my knowledge, ever, like, officially assigned the role of sniper, but he was a talented marksman. He, you know, so, and this, he scored this 212 on a shooting test, which is pretty impressive from what I've heard. Not a gun person. I don't have anything particularly wrong with him, just not really a gun person. While he's in the Marines, he ended up teaching himself some Russian. This is both understandable, but also a bit weird. Again, Cold War. This is the point in time when we really hate the Russians. So it's a little interesting that he has, you know, some apparently free time while being in the Marines. He taught himself some Russian. In 1959, he's discharged from active service to take care of his mother. He basically claimed family hardship. There's conflicting information on if this was a real reason for him to be discharged. There's some stuff that indicates he'd been kind of disillusioned with the Marines. He didn't like them. Hits in 9. That's what I've seen. It's impressive, but it's not like sniper god or anything like that. So joined in 1956 at age 17. 3 years later, he's leaving the Marines to take care of his mother. And there's a little bit of, is this, did his mom really need help, or was this, get me out of here? It depends on what source you look at. And unfortunately, he didn't really have, like, a diary or anything like that from the time that can tell us what he was thinking. I tend to believe that he was just tired of the Marines, because on September 20th of 1959, he just leaves his mother in Fort Worth and starts heading to the USSR. So he abandoned the U.S. He got into the USSR on a tourist visa in October, and on October 16th. Military disillusionment is what I would really think. It does also seem that he was sort of convinced to become communist, because he goes to the USSR to try and become a citizen. Even though we think of, like, the Cold War as, you know, we tend to think of, like, the Berlin Wall. What we forget about the Berlin Wall, what especially Republicans forget about the Berlin Wall was not intended to keep people out of the USSR. The Berlin Wall was intended to keep people in the USSR. The Berlin Wall was not, we don't want people coming into communism. The Berlin Wall was, we don't want people leaving communism. So you could go on tours, like, heavily state-sponsored. It's kind of like you see, you'll see documentaries of people who have gone to, like, North Korea for tours. Similar kind of thing happening. So Oswald gets in via a tourist visa. While he's in the USSR, they'll, like, you know, show him around. There's, like, specific hotels that are for these tourists. They're being guided around by handlers, especially. While he's there, he goes, I would like to join the USSR. They go, no. Which is kind of interesting. It kind of tells you. Some of the conspiracy theories think that, like, Oswald was a secret worker for, like, the CIA or something. This kind of tells you that he was no one special. Because the USSR wanted, like, people who were, like, scientists or who could, like, give them information. Or they wanted people that it'd be, like, shameful for the USA to lose. Oswald wasn't one of those. So he goes, I want to be a citizen of the USSR. They go, no. He hurts himself so that he has to stay longer, like he can't fly out. I can't remember specifically what he did. I want to say it's the equivalent of, like, you know, breaking a leg or something to avoid going on a school trip. And eventually he sort of gets them to go, okay, fine, you can stay. So Oswald, at a fairly young age, again, so 17 and 56, he's like 20 at this time. That's still, in my opinion, kind of young, dumb, stupid territory. I was not very intelligent. I mean, I was making semi-reasonable choices at 20, but not that many reasonable choices. So, 20 years old, he's left the USA for the USSR. And he ends up working as a LAF operator in Minsk. I know I'm pronouncing that wrong. That's a word that I cannot really pronounce. Basically, bog standard factory job. He's not a scientist. He's not doing anything impressive. It's just blue-collar working job, pretty much. But because he defected from capitalism, he's living quite comfortably. The USSR gave him a fully furnished studio apartment. They supplemented his pay. So he is not living the life of an ordinary person. He is living that privileged life. You know, there's... theoretically, in communism, there's not supposed to be any different levels of privilege, but, you know, there are. To find reasonable decisions. What decisions was I making when I was 20? I was in college? I was in college, so I was just making decisions about, you know, what college courses to take, and I came out with a, you know, I have a full degree and stuff, and so, you know. But yeah, he never went to college, obviously. You know, he went to high school, but he wouldn't have gone to college. So he's living kind of what is for USSR an upper class life. He's got a job, but he's got supplemental income. He's got a fully furnished apartment. He's living a probably a better life than he lived in America. You know, it a lot for your given definitions. But one thing I'll say about Oswald is that from the stuff I've read about Oswald, he just strikes me as, like, a flighty, inconsiderate, like, just never satisfied. Like, he, you know, he'd gone into the Marines and he kind of bopped out of that. He'd gone to the USSR. And by January of 1961, he's not sure he wants to stay in the USSR. So he's just not happy anywhere. He's got, I don't know, Someone probably out there's probably someone out there who's like an Oswald fangirl or fanboy who like describes him as like a gypsy soul, which I think the most unreasonable decision I made in when I was in my 20s, I might have been 21, I might have been 20, I can't remember, is that a bunch of my college anime sci-fi club, we were gonna watch the live action version of Avatar The Last Airbender with riff tracks because we knew it was horrible. So in preparation for that, we were making various alcoholic drinks. And one of the alcoholic drinks we were trying to make, I don't remember what the heck it was, but it was base drink, you pour a shot on top and you set the shot on fire. But we couldn't get the shot to light. So like four of us made this. And two of the four went, yeah, not going to drink that, threw that out. Me and one of my friends went, what the hell, we'll drink this anyway. It tasted like death. And by the end of watching the movie and drinking a few more drinks, specifically one that was called, my friend called it Therapy on the Beach with Your Sister's Friends, which was apparently a really cheap version of the drink Sex on the Beach. I was going back to my dorm and was very... I had to rely on a friend of mine to make sure I didn't fall asleep in a snowbank because this was, I went to college in Massachusetts. So I was not making maybe good decisions, but I wasn't going like, I'm going to go to North Korea. You know, that's kind of the equivalent. It's not as bad, but that's essentially what Oswald was doing, was he's like, you know what's cool? North Korea. And then by 1961, he's like, no, North Korea is not cool. So, January 1961, he's like, kind of don't like the USSR. But again, sort of demonstrating the fact that I don't think he makes very good decisions. In April of 1961, he got married. He married this young woman, Maria Proskova. I've forgotten how to pronounce it. But local, local woman. So married a local woman. He'd known her for a month. Yeah, again, Oswald didn't, in my opinion, in my kind of uneducated opinion, did not make very good decisions about what he was going to do with his life. Within a year, they have a daughter. And within that very short span of time, they're going back. So basically, you know, not that long after he entered the USSR, after he got married, June 1st, 1982, he returns to the U.S. with his wife and daughter. I think some of this plays into why conspiracy theories about Oswald are so popular, which is that when people think about the Cold War, they think of it as, you know, these two fortresses that are not allowing any pass between them. People went back and forth. And it was really only when you got, like, scientists and stuff going back and forth that the governments got involved. Again, Oswald was a nobody. He wasn't a really great soldier. He didn't have any, like, access to state secrets or anything. Yeah, exactly. That's good. Oswald sounds like a dude with wanderlust that never found something to ground him. Pretty much. There's a good quote I've got later on when we talk about conspiracies that I think is, like, the best summation of Oswald. So, he's going back to the U.S. 1982, goes back to the U.S. with his wife and daughter. In October of 1963, he starts working at the Texas School Book Depository. So again, this is where eventually he's going to shoot Kennedy from. But again, he's still a nobody. He's the most sort of interesting thing about him was this would be, you know, you go to work. It's like, hey, did you hear Oswald? Like, he went to the USSR. He's got like a Russian wife. What the hell? You know, it'd be kind of like office cooler gossip, but nothing like really big. So he shot Kennedy from where he worked, and we'll get into sort of why he shot Kennedy in a bit. But November 22nd, he shoots at Kennedy from specifically the sixth floor window of the book depository. So six floors up, shoots down. And although the cops didn't specifically know that he'd shot from there, like enough of them sort of thought, like they kind of triangulated the sound, like just in their mind went, we're pretty sure the shot came from that way. So cops rushed into the building. He sort of managed to sneak out the back way. And he goes on this sort of wandering, fleeing path. I'll recommend a book at the end of this, at the end of these slides, if you're interested in learning more about this. So he goes on this wandering path. As part of that, he ends up killing a policeman because a general description of him had gotten out. So this policeman, J.D. Tippett, tries to stop him because he meets, you know, he matches the description for, you know, this guy's wanted because we think he had something to do with killing Kennedy. So he kills a policeman at 1:15 p.m. And at 1:40, he is arrested in a theater. He'd basically gone into specifically what's called the Texas Theater in an attempt to hide from the police that are sweeping through Dallas. He is arrested in the theater. This is a photo of him being pulled out of the theater by the various, I think this guy's a detective and, you know, police officers. And he's taken to Dallas Police Headquarters. He's kept at Dallas Police Headquarters for 2 days. They're interrogating him. He doesn't really say anything. He's remarkably closed-lipped about everything that's happening. And then 2 days, so November 24th, the detectives are escorting him out. They're going to take him to the prison, you know, because they're like, okay, he's not answering anything. Let's take him to the prison and stash him there until we have a trial. As he's being escorted out, he is shot by a man by the name of Jack Ruby, and he dies. So, you know, 2 days after Kennedy's shot and killed, his assassin is shot and killed. This is understandably going to cause a lot of conspiracy theories. So, yes, there's actually a photo of this exact moment. So this is Jack Ruby. Here's Oswald being led out by, I'm forgetting the detective's name, but, you know, detective is leading out through this crowd of reporters. Jack Ruby just steps forward, and it's hard to see in this photo, but shoots him at pretty darn, you know, close to point blank. Here's another photo from a slightly different angle of the moment of the bullet hitting. I kind of love the expression of, like, what the hell on the detective's face. I think there's footage, but it's not very good footage. It's like a, they sort of pan over after the fact. So, three questions emerge from this. Why did Lee Harvey Oswald shoot JFK? What the hell? Who is Jack Ruby? And why the hell did Jack Ruby shoot Oswald? So these are kind of, in my opinion, the three questions that are kind of the basis for all of the conspiracy theories that come out of the JFK assassination. Quick answer to some of these. And some of them we'll look at more in detail. Quick answer. Why did Lee Harvey Oswald shoot JFK? We don't know. There might not really be a reason. The Warren Commission had this. This is the quote that I think sort of sums it up really well. The Warren Commission's sort of official finding is they said, Oswald seemed to be seeking for himself a place in history, a role as the great man who would be recognized as having been in advance of his times. They sort of tie this back to why Oswald decided to go to the USSR. They think that he sort of went like, oh, the USSR is going to come out on top. If I go to the USSR, they'll go, hey, that guy knew what was happening. He was ahead of the curve. The same thing with Kennedy, that Oswald had sort of kept vaguely communist. He'd had like some dealings with various communist organizations. But again, a whole lot of it just seems to be, and like kind of my opinion is that it was just he wanted to be someone. I'd say you could almost look at this as kind of the argument against identifying school shooters and mass murderers. You know, you've seen various arguments like that online of like, let's not name school shooters. Let's just give them a number. Let's call them insulting things. I think that very much feeds into it. I think he wanted to be remembered, and he didn't have anything in his life that he was going to be remembered for. So he, you know, maybe had joined the military thinking I'm going to be this great, you know, the war's going to come and I'm going to get fame and glory. That didn't happen. He went to the USSR thinking, oh, the USSR is going to win the Cold War and I'm going to get fame and glory for being the first person to come over. That didn't happen. He'd gone back to the USA going, I'm going to be like, oh, you came out of communism. That didn't happen. So he was just trying to be someone and nothing worked out. So, yeah, I tend to buy into that. I tend to sort of support that of just... Yeah, that's a You're making all the best points for me, Hinson. Oswald is the kid that does stupid shit for attention taken too far. Yeah, he wanted to be someone. And I have no doubt that if he hadn't gotten killed, he'd be the kind of person who, like, assuming that he didn't get, let's say alternate universe where he doesn't get shot by Jack Ruby and he doesn't get the death penalty, he just gets put in prison forever. He'd be the kind of guy that, like, every few years would be like, Oswald claims this, Oswald claims that, you know, to get back in the news. So, why did Oswald shoot JFK? Probably not a reason, or at the very least, the reason is probably not all that deep. Second question that gets brought up. Who the heck is Jack Ruby? He's an interesting character. He owned a Dallas nightclub / strip club, so he's a club owner for a strip club. He may have had some connection to the mob. More likely, he just pretended that he did. He's a kind of nobody, like maybe a sort of criminal, but that's it. He's not anyone important. He's not anyone that big. Literally, this is a man that if you take away the fact that he shot Oswald, there's nothing noteworthy about him. He wasn't even, like, the nightclub he owned, I think he owned, like, one or two. The nightclub he owned wasn't even, like, big or anything like that. Just kind of this, I think he, like, lived in a hotel, and I seem to remember reading something about, like, he had, like, a little, like, wiener dog or similarly sized dog that he just doted upon. But Jack Ruby's a nobody. So why did he shoot Oswald? He was upset about JFK's death. He'd been a JFK fan. He was upset about JFK's death, and he had an opportunity. Later on, Ruby would admit that it was just spur of the moment. That he had like a friendship with the police that I think he kind of cultivated in order to keep a strip club from being shut down. So he had kind of a friendship with the police, and he was able to get in close, and he had a gun. And yes, Ruby is pretty much the main reason why people think the mafia had it out for Kennedy. Because again, he sort of claimed to have mafia ties. I believe the claims were along the lines of, like, someone, like, you know, inconvenienced his club, and he went like, oh, I'll have my friends get you. I've never seen any, like, legitimate, like, well-sourced information about him having mafia ties. The most I've seen is like, yeah, this mafia guy went to his club once, but it was a strip club. Mafia guys tend to like strip clubs. You know, it's kind of like, if I own a bar, I'm probably going to have some criminals come to my bar. Doesn't mean I'm part of the mafia. So, a lot of this is unsatisfying. When, you know, when we have crimes, when we have horrible things happen, we like there to be kind of a good, is not the perfect word, but a good reason for what happened. But there's not really anything, you know, worth. All of this is very disappointing. I keep pointing the wrong side. All of this is very disappointing to sort of, you know, true crime seekers. So, understandably, this is where the conspiracy theories come in. And, this is going to be not a very extensive dive into JFK conspiracies, but it is going to be kind of a generic one. Yeah, that's a good, yeah. If he, again, his mafia ties, if he had actual mafia ties, it was a ship passing in the night. It was not anything meaningful. You know, it was the kind of line of like, I found out a few days ago that the Walmart I used to do my grocery shopping in last year when I lived in a different part of the state had a murder take place in it. It was, you know, not meaningful ties, you know, just kind of, you know, 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon or whatever that's called. So, conspiracy theories. I love conspiracy theories. I don't believe any conspiracy theories, but I love listening to them. I think probably my favorite conspiracy theory is the one where There are some people who believe that the Titanic that sank was not the real Titanic. That the Titanic was essentially a false flag operation. Maybe I'll do a thing about that at some point in the future. If you're interested in that, check out the League of Nerds podcast. It's Miles Powers' podcast that sadly he's not running anymore. You can find it on YouTube, and there's a very good video about that. I think he also did a video on his own channel about it, but it's crazy. So, a lot of JFK conspiracies pretty much just boil down to insert name here or insert organization here, knew that it was going to happen. So a lot of conspiracies are just like, the mafia knew JFK was going to get killed. LBJ knew JFK was going to be killed. Most of the time, those conspiracies go hand in hand with a lot of people think, oh, Oswald didn't work alone. So these are like common elements of conspiracy theories, of JFK conspiracy theories. Oswald didn't work alone is a very common element. Oswald was framed, so he didn't do it. He's the fall guy is another common element. Ruby got orders from somewhere / someone to kill Oswald. but no credible evidence has ever come to light. There's been no evidence ever come to light showing that anyone knew Oswald was going to shoot JFK. Oswald was sort of, he wasn't running, but he was like helping out like a local communist group. But he wasn't like creating the materials that he passed out or anything like that. You know, the FBI was sort of like keeping tabs on communists at this point. There's never been any evidence come to light that anyone knew Oswald was going to shoot JFK. From what little we have from Oswald and from his wife, because remember, he's married during this whole thing and he's living with his wife at the time. Even she, like she said, she didn't notice anything different. Like, it literally just kind of looks like, again, Oswald wanted to be someone who went, hey, the president's going to drive by where I'm working. There's never been any evidence showing that anyone worked with Oswald. No communications, you know, telephone records are a little bit more fragmented from back then just due to the fact that telephones weren't, you know, as common kind of. But there's never been any connections along those lines. There's never been any information that Oswald was framed for doing it. We have, like, if he was framed, it was the best frame job of all time. Because, he's on the sixth floor. If I'm recalling correctly, pretty much all of the book depository workers, because they interviewed everyone who worked there, they had said, like, you know, oh, we all decided to go to the third floor or something because that was the better view. Like, you know, if you're watching a motorcade, you kind of want to be a little bit lower down because then you can see over the crowd, so you're not on the street, but you're not, you know, looking at the top of people's heads. So there's a lot of good interviews of he went up to this floor, we saw him go up. I do like that point. If the CIA knew, they would have fucked it up. They're massively incompetent. Again, reminder, this is not that long after the Bay of Pigs. Bay of Pigs was, you know, CIA. So Bay of Pigs, CIA, very quickly. CIA had the amazing idea of what if we fund a invasion of Cuba by Cuban expats and we'll give them all this money and we'll give them supplies and it'll totally work out. And it was a massive, massive failure. So yeah, don't think that would have worked out that well. there's never been any evidence that there were other gunmen. The big thing that people point to is the magic bullet, which we'll discuss on, I think, the next slide, if I'm remembering my slides correctly. There's no evidence there was any other gunmen, and there's no evidence that Ruby had orders or was connected to anyone. While we don't have that much information about Oswald, we have a bit more information about Ruby. He kind of had a bunch of, he left more of a trace. He interacted with more people. So, like, you can form a pretty good timeline of where Ruby was and his movements and stuff like that. Yeah, the Bay of Pigs was secret for all of 9 hours. Something like that. Yeah, the Bay of Pigs was not, like, the thing about the Bay of Pigs is I feel like if the CIA was not even halfway competent, if the CIA was like 1/8 competent, they would have been able to hide the fact that they were involved. They would have been able to go like, oh no, it was rich people in the USA, not the government of the USA that funded it. Bay of Pigs is ridiculous. And you'll note that, I use this image because yes, there are definitely, I haven't encountered that much, but there's definitely people out there that think it was aliens, that think it was Illuminati, that think it was reptoids, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So let's look at specifically some of the biggest stuff. The magic bullet. the magic bullet, I can actually understand how people could be convinced by this. And the reason that people could be convinced by this is they don't know all the facts. They're looking at the bad sources. So, magic bullet. This image here on the slide, this is the bullet. This is a side view and, you know, top view of the magic bullet. Magic bullet is also called the single bullet. And basically, remember when I was talking about the order of events? There's three shots fired. One misses. One bullet hits JFK and Governor Connolly. One bullet just hits JFK. The magic bullet is the first bullet to hit. So this is the bullet that hit JFK, that hit Governor Connolly. The bullet did an amazing amount of damage. It went through JFK's neck, went through the governor's chest, through the governor's wrist, and into his thigh. And if you just hear that description and don't know anything else, you're kind of inclined to think that it's, you know, you're like, wait, how the heck can it hit all of that? People who believe that the magic bullet proves there were a conspiracy believe that the wounds don't line up. Because when you're shot, you know, bullet goes pretty much straight. But, you know, bullet goes, so all of the wounds should line up. And they'll point to stuff like this. I haven't gone to it. I really want to go to it. But there's apparently, like, a JFK conspiracy museum in Dallas, which has, I think this is actually taken straight from that museum. So you'll see diagrams like this, where they'll show you the path of the bullet. They'll be like, wait, how could the bullet go in here and then bump up and bump all these places? The reason? These diagrams are not correct. Because they assume, if you look at this, they assume that JFK, so JFK, President Connolly is the governor of Texas. They assume that they're sitting like this, perfectly in front of each other, you know, one in front of the other at the same level. When really, it's more like this. So, based off a misunderstanding, they were not sitting directly in front of each other. If they were sitting like this, the bullet wouldn't line up, but they're not. They weren't at equal height. And if you position them the correct way, the path of the bullet is straight. So this is what people think. This is what it actually looks like. So you'll see Connolly is lower. He was on this little like added jump seat. So Kennedy, Connolly is lower because of just the way it's set up. And then also he's angled off to the side. So it's a little bit more like that. And if you look online, you can find kind of 3D models that you can look into more along those lines. So once you have them in the correct position, it's a perfect match. Because you'll see specifically, like, they've got, you know, the arm up in the correct position. So Kennedy's kind of hunched over a little bit. Some of this is due to the fact that he had, I don't remember if it was scoliosis, but he had an issue with his spine where he actually wore a back brace. So he's kind of slumped a little awkwardly from the back brace. You can see that his shoulders are kind of up. You know, I'm over-exaggerating, obviously. His shoulders are a bit up, so it makes sense that it would hit that way. Connolly's turned to the side. You can see now how it all goes perfectly fine. So anytime you encounter someone who believes in the magic bullet, just throw it out. And this is not that hard to fix. If you look at footage from the day, and there we're going to look at the specific really big footage in a second, but there's a lot of footage you can find of the parade route of just, you know, Kennedy's car driving past, and you can tell, oh yeah, there was this different inside. And yeah, it's a moving vehicle is also going to be, you know, be part of it. People just kind of assume like, oh, they're right in front of each other. Where, you know, it makes sense for the car to be like this, because this is a car that is specifically designed for parades. So if it's specifically designed for parades, you want that kind of, you know, stadium seating where his, you can see, his butt is higher off the floor than Connolly's. We got the side view here, and then here's the correct overhead view. So you can see how it lines up. So again, they're not directly in front of each other. Connolly is lower. Once you have the things in place correctly, the bullet path is super freaking straight. Another element that really drives conspiracy theories is the Zapruder film. So the Zapruder film is named after the guy that was filming. Zapruder was his last name. He had just a home camera, an early home camera. The Zapruder film is the film which provides the most clear view of the assassination of JFK. There are other films that do capture it, but this is the film, as far as people believe. So it's shot by a man named Abraham Zapruder on his home movie camera. It has no sound, and the relevant clip is only a minute long. Basically, he started filming at like exactly the perfect moment just by chance. And it's a really sort of good footage of the assassination because of his position, which is sort of toward the grassy knoll. So I'm going to play the Zapruder film. A little bit of a trigger warning. It's not like super horrible, but it can be a little bit annoying. So I'm going to play it once and then I'll play it again, sort of talking through it. So there's no sound. Early home movie, no sound, but this is the Zapruder film. What they're referencing here is I'm probably forgetting part of this because I think it was more dramatic than this, which opened up some of the conspiracy theories, but he realized what he'd filmed because he was like, holy shit, I just filmed that. And he, I think, gave it to the FBI, but also arranged some kind of deal with Life magazine, which was like, Life magazine was a huge, I don't think it's still around, but it was like everyone had a copy of Life magazine. I think I even have. I should have looked that up before the stream, but my dad gave me some old copies of Life, and I think one of them might actually be this one. I'll have to look that up later. Just haven't looked them. So, I'm gonna mute it because they just put in random things. So, yeah. So, you'll see a few different versions out there because, as he mentioned, some of it was fixed. So, again, early footage. And this here is Kennedy's. And right about here is where the not-so-fun part happens. If you want to look away. So I'm going to back this up. What this shows is specifically the... I can't remember if it shows the first shot, but it specifically shows the second and third shot. And yeah, this is shot from the grassy knoll. So the film is being shot from what is referred to as the grassy knoll, and I'll get into that in a little bit, I believe, unless I've messed my slides up. So we have Kennedy's motorcade coming around this turn. Off to the side here, you can kind of tell by the sign, is the entrance to the highway that they were going to be taking on. The first shot... there's a specific point that people figure out where it happened, but it happens at some point before then. So as they come out, Kennedy has been shot for the first time, and he's reacting to that. He doesn't, it's believed they didn't quite know what had happened, but that first shot that hit both of them has happened. His wife is obviously concerned because he started to slump over. She knows that something is wrong, though I don't think she knew at the time. And as you can see there, that's the second shot. So that explosion of Kennedy's brain. This part is the really sad part, actually. It gets me. After Kennedy is shot, it blew out a chunk of his skull and his brain. And his wife probably didn't know entirely what happened, but she kind of unconsciously reacts by trying to grab it. So this right here is her trying to grab the part, her husband, part of his brain has come out while she's basically holding him. And the car's already started to, rev up. It's going to go off and get to the hospital now. So, Zapruder film. Super, super, huge in the field of, there are people who have, spent their entire lives, just watching that at the slowest speeds possible. So even though there's no sound, there was sound on that video, but it was just, I muted it because it's just sound they added in afterwards. There's no sound because early home movie cameras usually didn't have that. Remember, you know, it's only relatively recently that cameras that, you know, normal people could afford got anything close to good. You can clearly tell when Kennedy shot for the second time, so the shot in the head, the one that definitely killed him, that made it that he arrived at the hospital dead. And you can also, given various other things, people have been able to sort of pinpoint, like, the shot, the first shot to hit Kennedy happened during this time frame. This footage, because even though it's low res and grainy as all heck, that is a huge, like, that takes you back. The first time I saw that, I was like, holy shit. You know, when I show that in class, I go, you're going to see this happen. If you don't want to see that happen, look away now. People micro-analyzing this film, like, you know, projecting it really big and playing it really slow, going frame by frame, they look at this and they see that JFK's head, when he's shot, appears to move back and to the left. So they think his head moves back and to the left. There's the, you know, the JFK movie about the conspiracy, back and to the left, back and to the left. So people see that and they think of, like, hey, if I get punched in the face, I'm going to, you know, fall back from it. So they think if his head went back into the left, the shot must have come from the front and the right. Again, kind of makes sense. You know, the whole, you know, if you're thinking back to, like, you know, maybe you haven't had a physics class in a long time and you're just remembering, like, every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. But the thing is, human bodies are more complicated. So this is the grassy knoll theory, because if he, so again, the idea is, he moves like this, he's being shot from that direction. He moves back into the left, he's being shot from the front and the right. And the front right in this footage is the grassy knoll. It's literally just, there's an on-ramp to the freeway and there's a grassy spot there, a little hill. A knoll is a hill. So that's where the location is. So the conspiracy theories usually say that, yeah, that first bullet hit the back, because it's really hard to shoot someone in the back from the grassy knoll. So conspiracy theorists who believe this will say Oswald shot, but there was another shooter, is the conspiracy theory. So they think that there was a second gunman on or near the grassy knoll. Some famous examples of this. Watchmen, if you like the movie Watchmen, in the opening of Watchmen where they're playing, you know, the times they are changing, there's a scene in that which is the comedian shooting JFK. One of the X-Men, it's not X-Men First Class, I don't think, it's X-Men Days of Future Past, I don't remember. It's the X-Men one where Wolverine goes back in time. They have a sort of semi-throwaway line about Magneto trying to save Kennedy from a shooter and the implication being that it was on the grassy knoll. I feel like I've definitely seen stuff where people say, like, Winter Soldier killed Kennedy, or, you know, I feel like that's probably an element of canon in some of it. So this is a very, very popular one, is the idea that there was a second shooter who saw that Oswald had not, you know, got the headshot and so took the headshot. To debunk this, I'm going to go to Penn and Teller, because Penn and Teller are amazing. And there's a really good episode. Penn and Teller have a really good episode of their show Bullshit. Penn and Teller's Bullshit has a really great episode about conspiracy theories that talks about the JFK assassination. So this is the sort of refutation of that.
Footage-wide tape is the skull for our melt. Dr. Louis explained that a bullet penetrating a skull doesn't transfer much of its energy to the head. It's a tiny hole, slides right in. The brain doesn't present much resistance, and when the bullet pops out the other side, it pulls a lot of brain, or in this case, melon goo, with it. The bullet and goo make a little jet blast that pushes the melon head in the opposite direction. Watch. The bullet and goo make a little jet blast that pushes the melon head in the opposite direction.
So, breakdown of that, they have a melon wrapped in a certain kind of tape because that's a really good analog for a human brain. You know, most of our goo is on the inside. Your head is pretty darn hard, or at least hopefully it is. So, again, as they notice, they're shooting with an actual, the gun that they use is the same kind of gun that, that Oswald used. So humans, human bodies are more complicated. it's not just a matter of, you know, all the physics you learn in school, everything you learn in school is usually dumbed down. You'll notice, like, I don't go into too much detail with some of this because I'm used to teaching to high schoolers. So I'm giving you the kind of quick and dirty, and if you want to learn more, you learn more. That's awesome. But so the fact that if we go here,
the bullet and goo make a-
we know in this footage, because it's being set up, we know that the entrance of the bullet is this back smaller hole, and that the main force is coming out the front. So it's unfortunately a sad fact of this is how the human body works. You get a small entrance and a big exit. Sometimes you can get the reverse, but it's not always that complicated. It's not always, you know, simple. So a lot of this, a lot of sort of the JFK assassination is people applying what they know and not trusting experts. And it's people doing kind of a bare minimum of investigation and going with their gut. So things like they'll argue, one argument that I didn't really get into the slides there is they'll argue, let me actually switch to this view. One argument that I didn't really go into in the slides too much is they'll argue stuff like, you can't fire the specific gun. I'm forgetting the specific breakdown, but they'll say, oh, you can't fire that gun this many times. There have been many things that show, yes, you can fire that many times. You can't aim that many times. So it's a lot of applying what they know and not trusting sources. And this is something you see a lot, not just in conspiracy theories, but you'll see it in, you know, you'll see it in alt-med. So, you know, the idea of sort of, I think sort of pain is healing sort of stuff can function into this, where people think like, oh, I'm feeling something by, you know, applying black cell. I should therefore be getting something out of it. They'll think stuff like that. So a lot of it is they're not willing to trust the sources. And that's kind of understandable because if you go looking for books about the JFK assassination, most of the stuff you're going to find, which is kind of, there's probably a term for this, but I always refer to it as like popular history. So what I mean by that is if you go into a bookstore, you know, you can find stuff like this. This is a book I'm currently reading, Hemings of Monticello. Really good book. Highly recommend this. This is, for example, this book is about Thomas Jefferson had multiple children with an enslaved woman. This is about her and her family and really dives into the details of the time. Even though this book is fairly large, I would still consider it to be a kind of popular nonfiction. It's the kind of stuff that is going to sell. You know, this specifically it says up here, New York Times bestseller. It's the stuff that you don't have to be a historian to pick this up, to read it, and kind of get it. When it comes to the JFK assassination, the books like that you're going to pick up are going to be written by conspiracy theorists. If you want a book about the JFK assassination that is not written by a conspiracy theorist that debunks it, one moment while I grab this, enjoy the wonderful surroundings of my kitchen. So I don't have any of the smaller books about the JFK assassination because I haven't seen any. I don't want to specifically buy any off of like Amazon or anything like that. I'll look if I go to used bookstores, but I don't really want to spend, you know, any amount of money that's going to get back to the writer of those books in any way, shape, or form. But if you want a really definitive, good, in-depth book about the JFK assassination, you're talking something like this. This is Reclaiming History by Vincent Bogassi. I'm mangling all these names. This is a really good book about the JFK assassination. It's a bit dry, as kind of the really factual books are going to be, but this thing is insane. As an element, how you know this book is big? Comparing it, going back to how you know that book is historically accurate. Comparing it to this, Hemings of Monticello. Monticello, I can't talk. If you look at this book, and again, this is a book that was sort of written, intended for a more mainstream audience. Everything I'm holding here is endnotes. sources, etc. So bookends on page 662. So all this chunk here is the actual stuff it's telling you with a few pictures and stuff. This chunk here is just all acknowledgments, notes for the pages, sources, stuff like that. You know, fairly chunky amount. For this book, all of those sources, etc., aren't in the book. There's some acknowledgments in the book. The acknowledgments, and there's a bit of a bibliography. So, acknowledgments and bibliography. This book is 1,512 pages of information. This much of acknowledgments and some bibliography. And then it has a CD of end notes and source notes. Because there's that many that they couldn't fit it in. Everything else in here is a breakdown of the JFK assassination. I've read this before. I'm in the process of rereading it. I read this my senior year of college because the school library had a copy. But this book is an amazing breakdown. Like, it starts off, the first chunk of it is just a breakdown of the 4 days. Like, I think it starts the day before the assassination and, like, goes through just every single event day by, you know, moment by moment practically. So it breaks down, you know, the 4 days in November. It talks about how the investigation, the Warren Commission, all that goes in. It spends, like, a huge amount talking about the autopsy. It goes through, and it's divided into sections. So, like, the first section is, you know, what actually happened. The second section is, you know, what did not happen, just going through every single conspiracy. So I've always said, and I've sort of used this as a joke for my students, if you want to debate the Kennedy assassination with me, I'm going to need you to, at the very least, read this book. Again, highly recommend this book. It's probably freaking expensive. I got this for like Christmas a few years back because I'd wanted it for a long time. And my dad eventually was like, yeah, she wants a book, I'll get her a book. So, yeah, the problem with the Kennedy assassination is there has been a wealth. I'm sure there's other books. This is just the one that I happen to have firsthand experience with. There's been a wealth of information. This book, I think, weighs more than my cat. There's been a wealth of information, but most of the information is dry. Like, a lot of the Kennedy conspiracy theory stuff relies on, like, the author of the book will go, oh, I talked to Bob, and Bob has read the Warren Report. So it's very rare to get someone who will actually read the whole Warren Report who understand it, because in order to understand the Kennedy assassination, you need to have all this other information. There's a lot of stuff about the Kennedy assassination which you just can't really quickly write off. So that's my thing about the Kennedy assassination. Oh, I haven't read The Silmarillion yet. I keep meaning to. I have a copy, but I think I tried to read it once and it just wasn't working. I haven't been doing good at reading right now. I'm reading books right now. I've read a lot of fan fiction over COVID, but like, for going back to this, the Hemings book, I've been very slowly chipping away at this for like a year. I keep reading other stuff in between. And I was also teaching another class in addition to a history class this school year. So I had to read books like that as well. But yes, so that is your Social Science Sunday about the JFK assassination. And to be honest, I enjoyed that. I like ranting about history. It's kind of fun to rant about history in a way that I don't have to worry so much about, like, oh, this kid's going to get angry that I don't like Trump. So let's see here. I just haven't been able to focus for a lot. I think it's, you know, the whole, like, COVID's, like, put me in, like, a weird frame of mind. I haven't really been able to focus on reading anything longer than, like, a fanfic, or even watch. I have all these movies and stuff that I need to watch that I haven't. So, put it up to my people in chat. We can end there. Or I write fan fiction too, so I'm like very. I posted on one of my my fan fiction blog thing that I run. I'm like, I'm gonna be doing this, and I was a little like, oh, I wonder if someone's gonna come and be like, why haven't you updated this fanfic? But oh well. So I'll put it to my people in chat. We can end there, or if you want, I'd be down for if you want to do Russian Revolution had been the other option. So what do you say? Should we end, or should we talk about the Russian Revolution, which would be it's focused on the downfall of the Romanovs, aka the czars of Russia, the kings of Russia. Talks about Rasputin. Okay. We're going to talk about the Ruskies there. I've got people for Ruskies. Very cool. I'm also planning, just so you know, I don't know if it'll work, but if it did work, I should be recording this, and I will have a YouTube linked, because I know that I have at least one friend of mine who I told her, like, hey, I'm going to be doing this on Twitch, and she was like, can you put it on YouTube afterwards? Because I don't know what a Twitch is. So let's get that set up. Yay! It actually worked that time. Woohoo! Okay, so Russia with my horrible Russian accent. I don't think I can do any accent very well. The closest I get to doing a good accent is I have one friend that whenever I hang out around her, we both start doing, like, really kind of lame English accents. So, Russia, the behemoth, the everything is giant, everything is huge. Going back, doing some groundwork for what the heck we're talking about. 1800s, going back to the 1800s. In the 1800s, Russia is an autocracy. An autocracy is a government where one person rules with unlimited power. It is similar but different from a monarchy. The main difference, usually when we talk about monarchies, we're talking about monarchies like England. So in England, even back at this point, the king does not have complete power. The king kind of has to bow to other people. In Russia, that's not the case. Russia, pretty much up until the communists, did not really have any checks and balances on the power of the Tsar. The Tsar being the king of Russia, it's the Russian word for ruler, emperor, and you'll see it spelled a bazillion different ways. I tend to use the C-Z-A-R version, but you'll see it spelled many different ways, because Russia has its own alphabet, so, you know, we Americans and others as well, but definitely Americans, look at this and go, what? So, czar. So, Russia's an autocracy. It is a giant autocracy. The thing is that you always have to remember with Russia, even when you see it on a map, and yes, at one point, Russia did own Alaska. Russia sold us Alaska, and it was really freaking hilarious because literally, since this is in the past, when, you know, it takes a longer time for information to get from one side of the world to the other, basically, Russia went, hey, America, want to buy Alaska? And America went, yeah, sure. Pretty much right after the agreement was signed of transferring what would eventually become the state of Alaska from Russia to America, the news came out that they found gold in Alaska. So, like, if that had happened nowadays, it would have been, like, 11th hour, like, stop the presses, we're not selling Alaska. But they did. So, thing to remember about Russia is that, yeah, it's big, but even nowadays, there's not a whole lot here. Alaska, bigger than gambling debts, yeah. So, Russia, although it is big and it does have a lot of people, it does not have as much people as it could have, given the land that's in it. So again, some of this is, you know, a lot, as I said, like, this is just, I imported lessons that I usually give to students. So a lot of this would be refresher of England, both then and now, is what we call a constitutional monarchy. There is a king or a queen, depending on the time frame, but their power is not very important, not very big. I usually, when I'm teaching these lessons, I make the comparison of going, the Queen of England is kind of like the mascot of England. She's not really, you know, she's a celebrity, but she's not really like running the government. Because they, students, and even some adults, tend to think like, ooh, queen, what they say goes, off with their head. No. So yeah, not in Russia. In Russia, at this time, so again, going back to the 1800s, there is no elected government. The government is appointed by the Tsar. The Tsar is the be-all, end-all. The Tsar is the head honcho. What the Tsar says goes. There is a government, but most of the people in that government are there because they're married to the Tsar. They're friends of the Tsar. They're married to the Tsar's relatives. It's, you know, a buddy-buddy system. It is, you know, a swamp that needs draining. Another important thing to know about the Tsar of Russia is also the leader, specifically his title is Supreme Bishop, of the Russian Orthodox Church. And at this point in the 1800s, the Russian Orthodox Church is huge. It is similar to the church in medieval Europe. So the church has a huge influence on the life of everyone in Russia, and the head of the Russian church is the Tsar. Tsar also owns a lot of stuff. They own a lot of land, they own a lot of businesses. So in some way, one way or the other, the Tsar controls the lives of everyone in Russian society. He is the one at the top, what the Tsar says goes. You might be able to convince him to do other stuff, but you have to convince him. You can't actually stop him from doing stuff. There is no impeachment of the Tsar. Great example of this. You gave your ex-boyfriend your heart. Tsar Catherine the Great gave her ex-boyfriend Poland. So Catherine the Great gets the short end of the staff a whole bunch. Catherine the Great was a really kind of amazing ruler because she is not... she married into the title. Catherine the Great married Paul the First? It's, you know, it's one of those, like every noble family, they like to reuse names a whole bunch. So Catherine married into Russian nobility and then overthrew her husband and probably had him killed and proceeded to rule in her son's name, but just kind of doing whatever she wanted. So yeah, she made her, she made one of her boyfriends the king of Poland. It didn't really last for long, and it was like, you're king, but I still control Poland, but still made her boyfriend king of Poland. So at this point, 1800s, so again, this is pre-World War I, 1800s, Russia has three social classes. At the top is the nobility, so lords, ladies, the Tsar and his relatives. Tsar is the head of the nobility. Then there's the clergy, so the priests and all the other members of the Russian Orthodox Church. Russian Orthodox didn't really have nuns as much, like Catholic Church has nuns. Russian Orthodox doesn't really have as many nuns, so it's men. And then there are the serfs. You, in Russia at this point, you are either nobility, member of the priesthood, or you're a dirty, stinking peasant. So, the serfs. In Russia, if we were all magically transported back to Russia, we would all be serfs. You'd have to be very lucky. You might become a noble, but serfs. Most of them are serfs. Serfs make up the majority of Russia's population. They are like peasants, but worse. You will sometimes see the word serf and peasant used interchangeably. There is technically a difference between the two. Technically, a serf... Let's see. A peasant is a serf, but not all peasants are serfs. And yeah, little early for the dabbing Karl Marx. We're not at communism yet. For example, how is a serf worse than a peasant? In Russia at this point, you could legally beat your serf. You could sell and buy serfs. Serfs weren't even given the ability to marry other serfs until 1812. specifically from other estates. So serfs at this point are kind of like slaves. So if you know, you've got Bob's land, Lord Bob and Lady Cass have two peasant villages. If you're from one lord's place, you can't marry across it. You couldn't leave your village to marry someone else unless you had permission until 1812. So you could marry, but you had to marry the people around you because the lord or lady who owned your land didn't want you going somewhere else. Oh, I was betting that it was a serfs emote. So, kind of like slaves, not entirely, but very similar. Whereas in the rest of Europe, by this point, peasant, there was, you know, more middle classes. Russia still didn't have that. Russia was kind of always has been, at least for world history, not getting into modern day, but Russia's kind of always been several steps behind the rest of Europe in terms of like where they are with nobility and peasants and stuff like that. So 1812, serfs were able to marry outside of, you know, their little village, but they still had to get permission. So, you know, my lord, I want to marry Elizabeth from the town down the way. Can I please? Because again, they're essentially, you know, being used as really cheap labor. In the 1800s, 60% of serfs were illiterate. That's a number. Yay for finding errors in my own thing. 20% could read. I think I actually had the 20% right. So it should be 80% were illiterate. So yay for, this is something I always have with my students. I'm like, oh, look, there's an error. I'll fix that for the next class. So I think that was 80% was illiterate. If I'm remembering my sources correctly, most of them could not read or write. And their average life expectancy was 40 years. So I'm 30 years old. If I was a serf in medieval Russia, I would live for another 10 years and then die. So majority of Russia at this point are serfs. Then you have the next rung up, the clergy, the officials of the Russian Orthodox Church, priests, bishops, monks. This is all members. And there would be a hierarchy to them. But little background on Russian Orthodox, because I actually minored in religion when I went to college. I haven't really been religious since I was younger, as kind of can be evidenced by the fact that I've been watching Hannah and Jake for a long ass time. Russian Orthodox Church is similar but different from the Catholic Church. The two split in 1054. Russian Orthodox is more independent than the Catholic Church. So in the Catholic Church, there's this hierarchy that it all goes up to the Pope. Russian Orthodox has a similar thing going on, again, with the Tsar at the top, but it's not as focused. There's varying effects of this, but, you know, in Catholicism, again, simplifying, what the Pope says goes. You know, while back, the Pope went, guess what? Purgatory's not a thing anymore. And everyone went, okay. Again, simplifying. Russian Orthodox is a little bit more independent. So it's not quite as focused on, you know, what the top says goes. There's a little bit more room for kind of what you would mostly think of as non-Catholic Christian denominations. It's not as fractured. You know, it's not like Protestant, Episcopal, Methodist, etc. But there is a little bit more breathing room for individuals, I guess, is the way I'm going to put that. So each bishop in the Russian Orthodox Church is its own authority. The leader of the church is just considered to be the first among equals. So again, a little bit more fractured, not as focused on kind of unifying. Due to other reasons, the Russian Orthodox Church, at this time especially, was a lot more mystic than the Catholic Church. So yeah, Catholics like their saints and their holy water and their, ooh, touch the dead arm of the saint. Relics really creep me out. oh, God. The Russian Orthodox Church allows power bottoms. Yes. Russians are more mystic. They're more into, like, you know, miracles and, like, saints and icons, holy pictures that can do great things. Miracles, holy cures. this is going back to, again, the fact that I did religion in as my minor in college, and due to the fact that my college had this one Russian history teacher that I thought was the best freaking teacher ever, Konstantin Pleshchikov. Unfortunately, all my books of his are in a box right now. Otherwise, I'd pull one out. Konstantin Pleshchikov, specifically his book, Stalin's Folly. It's a book about how Hitler should have been able to take over the USSR in World War II. But pretty much every book by Konstantin Pleshchikov that I've read, I haven't read like his most recent one, is amazing. He was a teacher at my school. I took every single class I could have with him. It was amazing. I loved him. But so because of that, I took sort of Russian, I looked at Russian history, religious history a little bit more further. The big difference between the sort of origin. So again, there was this split from the Catholic Church in 1054. The reason for that split, Catholics believed at the time, I don't know if, I can't remember if this is still correct, but at the time, Catholic belief was that the Holy Spirit comes from God and Jesus, whereas Russian Orthodox believe that it just comes from God. So I am blanking on a bunch of religions, but, you know, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, that sort of thing from religious belief that there's sort of different, this is not going to be right, but it's vaguely sort of different versions of God. Catholics believe that both God and Jesus kind of give power to the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is kind of like both of them-ish. Russian Orthodox say, no, God is the one giving power to the Holy Spirit. And all of this originates from like how you translate a Latin text. And there's since been other stuff, but essentially that was the moment of like, we can no longer be one, we must split. So yeah, Russia, very, very mystic. Very mystic, and the church is very closely tied to the Tsar. Very, very closely tied. The Tsar and the church are very much in bed with each other. Possibly more literally, as we'll get into it. This guy will come back later. And of course, last but not least, you have the nobility. There's other members of the nobility. There's princes, lords, ladies, etc. But when it comes to Russia, you pretty much are talking about the Tsar and his family. The specific title, so the I am Tsar, you know, title of Tsar dates back to 1547 with this gentleman here, Grand Duke Ivan the Fourth? I think I'm doing Roman numerals correct. I always have to think for a moment. Grand Duke Ivan the Fourth got himself crowned the Caesar of Russia. So yeah, Tsar is related to, you know, usually seen the Roman term Caesar. It's basically the Russian version of that. He's 16 when he gets himself crowned. He takes control of Russia pretty much. He makes a new code of laws. He establishes the first sort of representative body, but it all bows to him. He allowed more rural regions of Russia to self-manage, kind of like, go along with me and I'll leave you alone at least a little bit. And he doubled the size of Russia. Thank you, The Life of Malkin, for confirming that I have my Roman numerals correct. I have to, like, flop my brain into Roman numeral mode. There we go. That's always the one that, the only thing about Russian numerals, the thing about Roman numerals that messes me up is remembering that it's, if it's to this side, it's a minus, you know, sort of thing. So, the first Tsar of Russia, the first guy to sort of gain control, and, you know, before it had just, Russia had been essentially a bunch of warring kingdoms. You know, this is a very usual, you know, monarchy story. We're going to talk about that hit soon, about the Don Bluth film. So Ivan the Fourth was described as intelligent, as devout, but he was also prone to paranoia, rages, and mental instability. So he's this very smart guy, this very religious guy, who just kind of flew off the handle every now and then. This gets him the nickname of Ivan the Terrible. Why the heck is Ivan called the Terrible? Well, there's many different accounts, but this is one specific one. Ivan the Terrible beat his daughter-in-law, so his wife's son, for wearing immodest clothing. Already not a good thing. You know, you're beating your daughter-in-law. Not a good thing. It gets worse. She was pregnant. He beats her for wearing immodest clothing. The beating led to a miscarriage, which killed his unborn grandson. I believe it was her first child, so she didn't have any other children. So, grandson died. I think she also died. Understandably, her husband, who was not just Ivan's heir, like the next in line to the throne, but his favorite son, understandably was not happy about the whole, you know, my dad killed my wife and my unborn child. So they argued. And Ivan killed his son. This is a really famous painting of Ivan accidentally killing his favorite son and heir. So kind of from the start, Russian monarchy insane. And yeah, a lot of royal families do have mental issues. There's a lot of very interesting things you can say about it. I keep meaning to read more about I think she was a princess of something like, somewhere in Europe, but like a European princess who, apparently there's a fairly common delusion among kind of European royalty that they have swallowed a glass violin or something along those lines. That a lot of different like European royals have had this belief that they've swallowed this glass item that if they're not careful is going to break. I think some of it likely arises from, you know, there's sort of that duality of if you're being raised royal, especially at this time, you're being protected, but you're also always in danger. You're being kind of bowed to, but you're kind of not at the same time. Ivan was kind of like, from the accounts I've read, was that he did a lot for his country, but he was very mentally unstable. I'm trying to remember if it was him. There was some royal, but I can't remember if it was Ivan or if I'm thinking about one of, like, the Spanish royalties where, like, actually, I think it might be, I might be thinking about one of, like, the Habsburgs that, you know, the Habsburgs is the example of, like, crazy inbreeding that I read an account once that was, like, from one of these guys' diaries where he's just like, why have I been cursed? I'm so horrible. Stuff like that. So, yeah, Ivan the Terrible, not very good. When he dies, his son, Fyodor, again, I'm going to mangle all of these because I don't speak Russian. I speak, obviously, English and some French. I am, like, semi-fluent in French, so I think I tend to try and pronounce stuff the French way, and that doesn't help me when I'm trying to do Russian or German. So this is Ivan's son, not the one who, you know, obviously hadn't killed his favorite son. So this is his, like, backup son. He may have had an intellectual disability or a learning disability. As always, when we're looking at history, the perception of intelligence, the perception, you know, obviously they wouldn't have had, you know, the words intellectual disability. That wasn't the thing they knew about. Talking about mental issues when it comes to historical stuff is a lot like talking about LGBTQ when it comes to historical stuff. The way that we perceive sexuality, gender, etc. now would have been completely alien to people back then. So, as always, there's going to be a little bit of we think, but we're not sure. Yeah, no one speaks English. We all just pretend that we do, and we've agreed to pretend that we all do. So Fyodor might have had, again, this is, Ivan was the first person to unify Russia. This is the second Tsar of Russia, and things are not going too well. Either way, if he had an intellectual learning disability, whatever, he wasn't a good Tsar. He pretty much just went, hey, brother-in-law, take control of the country, so that he could run around looking at churches. Another weird typo. Man, there's a bunch of weird typos in this. That should be churches, as in multiple churches. And listening to bells. He was really into bells. I wish I had a bell so I could be like ding, ding, ding. He apparently really liked bells. I don't like bells. Or at least I don't like the bell choir. Some church. The only time I go to church now is my mother attends a Methodist church, and every time the holidays roll around, she, like, what she wants for Christmas is she wants my siblings and I to go to church with her. So I will only go to church, like, for the Christmas service, and they have one of those, like, bell choirs where they ring the bells, and something about those bells just, I don't like them. Yeah, he spent all of his time running around. He was a very, very into religion, very into church bells. He was married for 12 years before he had a daughter, which, considering the purpose of marriage, especially for czars, was to have kids, and considering the fact that, you know, even if there were, like, condoms and stuff around back then, he wouldn't have been doing it, tells me that he was not that interested in his wife. But his daughter died at 2 years old. He never had another kid. So when he died, so did his family's dynasty. So Ivan the Terrible managed to have himself and one other czar, and then Ivan's bloodline is gone. I think there were other kids of Ivan's, but essentially Russia fell into just this mishmash of horrible. It's called the Time of the Troubles. So from 1598 to 1613, everyone is squabbling. The czar had died without any heirs. Everyone was trying to be czar. Just everyone throwing their hat in the ring to try and be czar. There was also a famine from 1601 to 1603. Just not a good time to live in Russia. The famine killed 2 million people. Russia's big. Which was one third of the population. So there's a massive civil war going on. There's a famine that kills a third of the population. In the midst of all this civil war, there was a whole bunch of people who would come forward going, "I'm Ivan's son." 3 different guys pretended to be one of Ivan's sons, specifically one named Dmitri. Man, there's so many typos in this that I'm annoyed I didn't catch last night when I was looking at this. The best part of this, when I last gave this lesson, is I had a kid in my class whose name was Dmitri. So when I read this line, everyone in the class turned to look at him, and instantly he just went, "Well, I am Ivan's son." That kid was awesome. So 3 different people are saying, "I am secretly Dmitri," who had, like, died earlier, so they're all full of shit. The Troubles is a fairly generic thing. I'm pretty sure that most countries have had the Troubles, or specifically this is the Time of Troubles. You know, it's just, you know, it's like civil wars. Everyone's had a civil war. Troubles, everyone has trouble. That's what happens when you name things very non-specifically. So there's this whole crazy mess, whole civil war, all these people pretending to be people and just doing things. But in 1613, one noble family comes out on top, and that family is the Romanovs. So the Romanovs come out on top right here with their first one, Michael the First. And they will have the Romanov dynasty. You will also see it spelled other ways, mostly with an F, as in, like, you know, Black Widow, Natasha Romanov. Romanov dynasty. Yeah, everyone's had a revolution. Humans just like our revolutions. We just like to go out and, like, throw stuff at people. I think it's very, you know, deeply ingrained part of being human is the desire to go out and, like, just punch people in the face. So, Romanov dynasty, usually when I teach this, I'll usually do a little project that I usually have students choose one of the earlier Romanovs and do like a little biography report. So we're going to jump straight to kind of the last few Romanovs. The Romanovs came out on top. I know there's at least one that there's, I mean, any royal family is going to have ones where it's like, we're pretty sure this guy was gay. That factors a little bit more in with the Romanovs. I would classify at least one Romanov czar that we're going to talk about as a bottom, or at the very least, like a, if he's anything, he's like a service top. stuff I can't talk about with high schoolers. That's fun to talk about on Twitch. So we're going to jump to the last sort of 3 Romanovs to rule. So jumping forward in time. Tsar Alexander II with his very impressive mustache. So we're jumping forward. We've sort of gone back to talk about time troubles. We're now talking about this guy who ruled from 1855 to 1881. He's worth noting because he was something of a reformer. So he ended serfdom. In 1961, he ends serfdom. This frees millions of people and their families. They're no longer required to stay on the lands that they've been born on. It's making serfdom doesn't end entirely. There's still, like, all these people at this very low level of the social hierarchy. But he ends it. He says, you know, you can do this, you can do that. More importantly, because, as always, like, a grand gesture only means something if you follow it up with the actual means to do something. So, for example, American history, freeing the slaves. Cool, good. Giving land to the freed slaves. We kind of failed on that. You know, the whole, after the Civil War, that America really dropped the ball. He does a little bit better in not dropping the ball. He sold a bunch of land, because, again, the Tsar owned a lot of land in Russia. The Roman, you know, the family owned a lot of land. He sold land to the serfs, and he gave them really good terms in paying for it. It's like 49 years to pay it back. So that's a good thing, because if you're free, it doesn't mean much if you literally have, you know, nothing to support yourself with. He also introduces the jury system to Russia. Before this point, there were no juries in Russia. There's just, you know, sort of judge-jury situation where the judge is the one deciding your fate. He gave Russians more rights in general. Yeah, this is kind of the Russian version of 40 acres and a mule, but they actually kind of followed through on it. He let more people go to school. Before this point in Russia, while they did have kind of universities slash equivalent, you know, institutions of higher learning, there were very few and far between. A lot of them were limited to you had to be a member of the nobility. Now he opens it up. He basically allows a middle class to form. Before this, there wasn't really a middle class in Russia. There was the nobility, the clergy, and the poor guys, the serfs. Now he's going to let a middle class form via his reforms. He also made it so everyone could be drafted, which is both a good and a bad thing. I personally don't approve of the draft. I don't like the idea of everyone having to be, but I think if you're going to have a draft, everyone should be eligible. So, for example, the fact that in America right now, we haven't used it, but we have the mechanics in place for a draft. However, if a draft was happening, women would not be part of it. I don't think that's fair. I think that if you're going to have a draft, you should have everyone be drafted, not just men, for example. Again, not really a fan of the military. I'll put it this way. I support the people in the military because I know that sometimes that's like literally the only fucking thing you can do. I've known a few people who the military was their only way they were going to pay for college. The military was the only thing they could do to support their family, etc. So I support the people in the military because I feel like they've gotten the bad end of the stick. I don't support, you know, military-industrial complex in general. So Tsar Alexander II makes it so everyone can be drafted. So it's not, before this point, it had been pretty much just the serfs. Now he extends it to nobility, though, of course, when the nobility get drafted, they're going to be, you know, officers, etc. I support the people of the military. I do not support the military. I do not support the amount of money that goes into the military, all that various jazz. Alexander II is also the one, he sold Alaska to the United States for $7.2 million. But there's a problem. He's a big reformer. He's doing more than like generations of his family had. The problem is that once you taste a little bit of freedom, you're like, ooh, that tastes good. I want some more freedom. So him giving stuff, giving freedoms to Russians, led to Russians wanting more. And he said no. He reached his limit. He said, nope, not going to do more. So he's assassinated in 1881 by two bombs. How this works. Him and a few members of his family, definitely his wife, I think a few of his kids and assorted relatives, they're going for a ride in a carriage around, I want to say St. Petersburg, but I might have the town wrong. So they're going for a ride in their carriage, and a anarchist throws a bomb at the carriage. The bomb explodes, but the carriage is a special carriage. The carriage had been specifically built to resist bombs, because they're nobility, and they know people don't like them. The bomb explodes. No one is harmed. Basically, like, they're rattled. There might have been a few, like, basically, you know, like, superficial cuts sort of injuries, but no one's that badly hurt. But then, for some reason, Tsar Alexander II decides to get out of the carriage. And it turns out the assassins had a second bomb. So, if history class, if this stream teaches you one thing, if a bomb goes off, get out of the area. Don't get out of the carriage and stare at the damage, because then you're going to get killed by a bomb. So yeah, technically killed by two bombs. Alexander II dies 1881 after that assassination. And his son, who decided that he was not just going to go for the mustache but the full honking beard, takes over. And here we have, you know, Alexander II, Alexander III. I sometimes joke that if I had one wish, it would be that noble families wouldn't use the same name over and over again. Because, dear God, even, like, when you teach in a public school, you're usually not just teaching one class. You're usually teaching, like, three world history classes and, like, maybe another class as well. So, for example, most recently when I was teaching, my course load was three world history classes, one class of drama, and one class of a thing called academic literacy, which was kind of like a study skills class. So you teach the same lesson three times a day, or, you know, depending on the schedule, it might be spaced out. Even when I was teaching like that, I would still get, like, which one is this? Is this Alexander II? Is this Alexander III? Use different names, royal families. Like, at the very least, like, separate your names out. Like, maybe have an Alexander and then two other names and then another Alexander. Make it a little easier for historians. So Alexander III takes over after the assassination of his father, and he's understandably not too happy. He thought, you know, hey, my dad died because he was being too liberal. So he's not going to be liberal. He is a pushback against the relatively liberal nature of his father. He says, I'm going to bring back the autocracy. I'm going to strengthen it. I'm going to make Russia great again. This is kind of the Trump of Russia. Not really, but kind of. And he introduces totalitarian methods. So, the children must carry on the name. Usually when I teach, I use this as an intro. I will teach, like, sort of about the Russian Revolution before I go into, like, Rise of Hitler and stuff like this. So I often use Russian Revolution as, and, you know, both in terms of the Romanovs, in terms of Stalin, etc., as a way of teaching what totalitarianism is. So totalitarianism, government that restricts opposition and individual expression. Totalitarian, hello, son of Mentides. Nice to see more than two people talking in the chat. I love that you're all talking in the chat. It makes me feel like I'm not just talking into the void. Totalitarianism, the easiest way I explain it to students is a government that wants total control. They want to control everything. So Russia had been sort of totalitarian before this dude. This is the point where it's like, I will control everything. You killed my father. I'm pissed. So some of the ways that he uses to control people, he does a lot of censorship. So he even goes so far as to censor private letters, which is something that really rarely happens historically. Historically, censorship of private letters has been kind of limited to wartime. So, like, World War I, World War II, you'll see, like, letters getting blanked out because they contain troop movements, etc. To censor private letters in peace time is really kind of out there. He also makes really good use of the secret police. His focus with the secret police is on high schools and universities. He has teachers spying on their students because in Russia especially, but in general, college is a spot where a lot of revolutions happen. There's a lot that can be said about the connection between universities, colleges, and revolution. A lot of it because usually when you're in college, you've got some free time on your hand. So sort of you're able to participate in more revolutionary activities than you would if you were out of college in a job, or than you would if you're in, like, high school, then relying upon a parent to, you know, ferry you places. Anyone suspected of committing revolutionary activities, of going against the Tsar, is sent to a gulag in Siberia. So Siberia, again, Russia really big. Siberia is this whole big chunk of Russia where there's, like, nothing. You know, it's the reason why, even though Russia's big, even though Russia has a huge population both then and now, it's just miles and miles of snowy nothing. And this is essentially very similar to sort of concentration camps during the Holocaust, that some of them would have stuff they're making, like there were mines, there were lumber mills, etc. But the big idea of the gulag is just to have people die there. Very often, the way that gulags would start is they would gather up a whole bunch of prisoners, put them on a train to the middle of nowhere, kick them off the train, go make a camp. Nothing there, make a camp. Lots and lots of death. So, he also is really focused on something that's common in totalitarianism, which is uniting the country. Alexander III thought that if he could unite Russia into a single culture, it'd be more loyal to him. Because, you know, like with any country, we think, oh, Russia, and we kind of think of it as one thing. Just like other countries probably think of America and think of it as one thing, when, as we know, there's a difference in different areas. That was especially true in Russia. There's a lot more sort of individual, not tribes, but that's the word that's coming to mind, of, you know, areas of different cultures, languages. So Alexander III cracked down on this. He oppressed different groups, different ethnicities. He made Russian the official language and would punish people for speaking other dialects. Specifically, he outlawed the teaching of other languages like Polish and Hebrew. Most of what is now Poland was under the control of Russia at this point. And unfortunately, Jewish people are always the ones that get the smackdown when stuff like this happens. So he's very anti-Semitic. Not very happy. Not very good. Begin a period of anti-Semitism. The very famous anti-Semitic fake document, the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, is actually originated in Russia around this time. It was specifically written to kind of be used for stuff like this. So in Russia under Alexander III, Jews were not allowed to buy land. Jews could not live among other Russians, so they're having to live in specific areas. Universities in Russia were only allowed to admit a certain number of Jews. So it's like you have 100 students, one of them can be Jewish. And pogroms, so violence against Jews, broke out all over Russia. If you've ever watched the movie Fievel, An American Tale, the movie about the little mouse who helps with the Statue of Liberty, that starts out in Russia with a pogrom taking place. So specifically, pogrom is state violence with Russian police and soldiers either participating or just standing by and watching. So this actually led to a lot of immigration from Russia during this time. A lot of immigration to other areas of Europe. Specifically, I think one big element was there was a big contingent of Russian Jews who relocated to Germany, also to America and other places as well. So not a good time in Russia underneath Alexander III. He fairly quickly transitions to Tsar Nicholas II. I think he just died of old age. He might have died of assassin. I've forgotten. I forgot to put a slide in about that. But Alexander III dies, and he's replaced by his son, Tsar Nicholas II. Tsar Nicholas II will be the last Tsar of Russia. And I'd like to take this moment to show you all of Tsar Nicholas II's titles. So, last Tsar of Russia is the easiest one. This is his, like, official long-form title, and I actually, if you notice at the bottom, had to cut off some of it. I think some of his official title actually included and so forth, but literally just Nicholas, Emperor and Autocrat of all Russians, of Moscow, Kiev, Vladimir, just like, you think, you know, just all Russians, just leave it at that. We don't need to know that you also control Perm, Sovereign Lord of Yevhenia, Hereditary Sovereign Possessor of this Mountain Princes and of others. Just like all these titles. He is actually pretty. The Russian nobility kind of managed to escape a lot of the fugly that crept into Europe. I mean, they're not the Habsburgs. They at least did a fairly decent job of, you know, not marrying within the family that much. They did have inbreeding issues, as we'll definitely talk about, because it helped lead to the downfall of the Russians, but he is pretty handsome. But yes, this is the point where we're getting to World War I. So Tsar Nicholas II is the guy in charge when Russia joins World War I, and bad things happen. At this point, we're going to talk about everybody's favorite mad monk, Grigori Rasputin. Ra-ra Rasputin, as they say. So Grigori Rasputin lived from 1869 to 1916. He was a Russian mystic and self-proclaimed holy man. So even though we call him a monk, he was never, like, officially part of a monastery or anything like that. He just sort of went, I'm a monk. And everyone went, sure. And the reason that we know who the heck Rasputin is that Rasputin got a, he got the, people started thinking he could heal people. He was a self-proclaimed holy man who said that he could heal people. So actually, going back a little bit, Nicholas II marries, I want to say his wife's name is Alexandra, but I'm not sure if that's correct. I think it is. Nicholas II married one of Queen Elizabeth's grandchildren. And the Tsar and his wife were having trouble having a son. And having a son is a big thing in Russia, whereas other nobility, other monarchies at this time had sort of gone like, if we have a daughter, it's not the end of the world. Russia was really focused on, you gotta have that son. You gotta have that son. Can't have it. You gotta have a son to be the next in line. So the Tsar Nicholas had a bunch of daughters, one of which being Anastasia. When his wife was trying to have a son, she basically threw herself into Russian Orthodox. She was just like listening to every rumor of like, hey, if you go to this monastery and bathe in this pool, you'll have a boy. If you do this, you'll have a... She's like trying all of like, it's like someone trying to get pregnant and trying like every little thing that anyone tells them. Eventually she has a son, Alexei, but her son has hemophilia. So hemophilia is, you cut yourself, like I have all these horrible things on my arm. And the hemophilia is your blood doesn't clot. So, you know, usually like the other day I was cutting a bagel and I got myself this little cut on my pinky and it's now clotted up. There's a little, thing of dried blood that's keeping it from bleeding. If I had hemophilia, that would just bleed and bleed and bleed and bleed and I could die from it. We know now that, and they sort of knew at the time that the mom was responsible. Because again, hemophilia was at this point starting to be a problem all over Europe. And people have traced it back to Queen Victoria. Am I getting my English queens right? I think I am. That before that point, hemophilia wasn't present in the royal bloodlines of Europe. But then she had like 7 kids and all of her kids had like 7 kids and she married her kids into every royal house everywhere. So the wife brought the genetic predisposition for hemophilia in, and unfortunately the son happened to have it. And at this point in time, hemophilia was pretty much a death sentence. Nowadays we have, drugs that people can take that, that makes it not a big thing. Back then, like the only way to stop someone from bleeding was doing stuff like cauterizing the wound. So like there's one account of a prince of England, I think, who had hemophilia and he kept getting nosebleeds and they had to like cauterize inside of his nose. So like hot iron in the nose to stop him from bleeding. The other big problem with hemophilia is that it's not just surface cuts. Normal day-to-day life, just by moving around, you cut yourself inside, basically. You give the like rips and tears on your insides. If you're hemophiliac, those don't heal up either. So you start bleeding eternally and you'll get stuff where like the blood will go into your joints, into kind of the empty space there and swell up. And it's really uncomfortable. It's really painful. And there's not really anything you can do because if you cut it open, then you're bleeding out entirely. So it was a very dangerous thing for the future of Russia, which is what Alexei was to have. It was a very painful thing. There's accounts of just Alexei's mother just sobbing at his bedside because she couldn't do anything. At one point, one of her friends went, hey, I know this monk who's able to heal people. Let me ask him to heal your son. The weirdest thing, it seems like he actually was able to do something. Like, obviously we're going off of accounts from, like, diaries and stuff like that, but there legit seems to be at least some kind of correlation between Rasputin and Alexei. I've seen accounts that indicate that he kind of lucked out by virtue of doing nothing. Like, he would tell, like, let your son go to bed, don't bother him, and he'll be fine. Which would actually work out because, like, it would sort of stop on its own. Kind of like sometimes you'll get with the alternative medicine where they'll take credit for stuff that was actually fixed by real medicine. So there's some of that, but there is does also seems to be accounts. Like, there's at least one account of Rasputin was out of he lived in the palace, like in the like with them a lot. But there was one time where he was out in the country, like visiting relatives, and something happened to Alexei. I think he like fell off a horse or something. And they legit thought he was going to die. Like, they were giving him last rites. And they called up Rasputin and he said, like, he'll be fine. I'm healing him remotely. And Alexei recovered. So I don't believe in miracle cures, but I think Rasputin kind of lucked into it. So because of this, because he had this seeming ability to cure the heir apparent, the future Tsar of Russia. If things had gone on straight, Alexei would have become the next Tsar of Russia. So when Nicholas, the Tsar of Russia Nicholas, had to leave to go, you know, check on World War I, because World War I's happening at this, his wife, Alexandra, took control, and she relied very, very heavily on Rasputin. She would consult him on everything. It's a little bit kind of looking back, it looks like she didn't quite know what she was doing. Like, she'd suddenly been put in a position where, you know, she's essentially being asked to be the Tsar of Russia, which she would not have been asked to be before. And because she's already thought that, oh, this guy can heal my son, maybe he's got a direct line to God. Maybe he can tell me what the heck I need to do. So she relied very heavily on Rasputin. And Rasputin wasn't that interested in stuff, / Russia was not doing well. World War I was a really freaking stupid war. Really, I think all wars are kind of stupid, but World War I was a really stupid war. So as Russian defeats mounted, because Russia was not doing well in the war, both Alexandra and Nicholas, but definitely Rasputin, became very, very unpopular. It was really easy for the people of Russia to blame Rasputin for the, like, it's all Rasputin's fault. Rasputin is leading the Tsar astray. They would publish little cartoons like this of Rasputin as this, like, looming figure kind of, you know, tending to this. Nicholas looks really creepy in this one. So, again, Rasputin kind of becomes the boogeyman. He becomes the man that is blamed. They blame the Tsar and Tsarina as well, but they blame Rasputin more. And specifically, the Russian nobility. So the Tsar's family, his extended family, aunts, uncles, other nobility around them, they become convinced that Rasputin is a threat to the Russian Empire. That's right, World War I was caused by a sandwich. Damn you, sandwich. We'll talk about that at some point in the future when we do the main causes of World War I. Damn you, sandwich. So the Russian nobility become convinced that if they get rid of Rasputin, they're going to fix everything. They think, like, oh, we're not the problem. Well, they are the problem, but they think, we're not the problem. It's Rasputin. Rasputin is the problem. We got to get rid of Rasputin. So, two specific members of the Russian nobility, they're like cousins of the Tsar. I can't remember the specific, you know, third cousin twice removed or whatever. This is Grand Duke Dmitry Pavlovich and Prince Felix Yusupov. Yusupov has a palace in St. Petersburg. This is that palace today. It's a museum or something, you know, most things are. They decide that on December 17th, 1916, they're going to invite Rasputin to a basement of this palace for a nice little party. And they are going to kill Rasputin dead. What follows is an account of what happened that night from the memoirs of these two gentlemen. So, here we have our members. They are all together in this little basement. They give Rasputin some cakes, some pastries, and some tea. Both of the cakes and both the tea contains a massive amount of poison. Like, each one contains enough poison to kill, like, two men. Rasputin eats all of it and is fine. So they give him some wine, also with a bunch of poison. Rasputin drinks it all. Not one glass, not two glasses, but three glasses, heavily laced with poison, and is fine. I think I saw an account once where they said the amount of poison put in all this food was enough to kill, like, three elephants. So just downing poison like it's nothing. At 2:30 a.m., the two conspirators start to get a bit concerned. They're like, what the hell? He ate all this poison, drank all this poison, and he's like, he's fine. Nothing bad's happening. So one of them pulls out a gun and shoots Rasputin. They're like, okay, cool. They go outside because they're like, we just shot Rasputin. We're going to go up and collect ourselves before we figure out what to do with the body. They come back down. He's not dead. Mass amount of poisoning, shot, I want to say, in the chest, not dead. At this point, they're understandably a bit freaked out. So the other one now grabs the gun and shoots him. They're like, okay, we think that worked. They grab his body, they pull it up, and they take it to the Pretskovy Bridge over the Malinevka River. Watch me mangle Russian. This bridge over that river. This is what it looks like more recently. They throw his body in. So at this point, he'd been massively poisoned, shot twice. Some accounts have it that he was also shot a third time, that when they took him out of the basement, he tried to run away. They throw him into the river. It's very cold. This is his body when it was pulled out the next day, you know, pretty much frozen solid. Some sources say that water was found in his lungs, indicating that he was alive when he went into the water. And because this was originally intended for high school, I actually do not have any information about that. There have been multiple people and places over the years that have claimed to have Rasputin's preserved penis. Because Rasputin had this belief that in order to get into heaven, you had to sin a whole lot on earth and, like, repent. Basically, he had this idea that you had to have something, you needed to be able to ask forgiveness for something before you could actually go into heaven. Like, if you did nothing your whole life, you wouldn't maybe need to get into heaven. So he famously slept with a lot of women. And, like, there's accounts of him, like, showing his penis to a lot of women. When I was in college, that same Russian history teacher that I really liked, he showed us a bunch of clips of, I don't remember the specific name, but it's a Rasputin bio documentary, whatever, where Rasputin is played by Alan Rickman. So there's a movie out there where Alan Rickman, you know, Snape, plays Rasputin, and our professor played a few videos from that. They were amazing. So various people, museums, etc., have claimed to have Rasputin's penis. One of the more famous ones is, it's like a sex museum somewhere. I want to say, like, the Netherlands. But the one I know of, like, one was definitively proven to be a horse penis. So they you know, doctored a horse penis a bit to make it look. Another one, I think, was actually a sea cucumber. So to my knowledge, and I think if you follow, I'm forgetting her name. I think I have a link to her. I have a video of hers later on, but there's this really, Ask a Mortician on YouTube. I'm forgetting her specific name, but Ask a Mortician on YouTube. I'll have a video of hers later in these slides. She has an episode about Rasputin's penis. The penises of famous men. But again, because it was supposedly, people have always, like, you know, he was supposedly this great lover or something. So, of course, the fact of the matter is that Rasputin was not singularly responsible for Russia. Russia's problems were a lot more far-reaching than one monk. And eventually, things are going to come to a head. Things things had always kind of been going to come to a head. This is all happening with, like, kind of World War I going on in the backdrop. Russia was behind the times. Remember, Russia did not have a legislative body. They were still completely monarchy. They were autocracy. They were completely monarchy. Whereas during this time, during this time, World War I, France has thrown off their king. France no longer has a king. France is a republic. England still has a king, but the king is not in complete control. You know, similar to a lot of these little countries, the kings are losing control. So it's not so much a matter of would this not have happened? It would have happened eventually. And World War I just brought things to a head because everyone's going and dying in Europe for a really stupid reason. So the people at home are like, what the heck? You know, king got us into this. Let's get rid of the king. So February Revolution in 1917, Russia's capital is Petrograd, which is right here. Russia's capital is Petrograd, also known as St. Petersburg, because Petrograd is Russian for Peter's city, and it's named after the saint. Things really get rolling. People have been really pissed off. People have been annoyed. People are not liking what's going on. But what starts things rolling is in February of 1917, when the textile workers, specifically female textile workers, go on strike. So those are people, textile is clothing. So they're doing cloth, they're doing clothing, anything to deal with that. This can be sort of pointed to as the beginning of the Russian Revolution. The women are on strike because of rationing and the rising cost of bread. And this is something that you'll see a lot in history, you know, bread. Bread is a big motivator. And the reason that bread is a motivator is that bread is what everyone is eating. We still eat like a lot of bread. You know, I feel like we still eat a lot of bread, but we eat nowhere near as much bread as we used to eat. Bread was the staple food. It was, you had bread every single day. So the cost of bread, the availability of bread, was closely tied to, are you starving? The best comparison I can make is imagine if suddenly the McDonald's dollar menu started going up in price. Because, you know, right now, if I have a dollar, I can go and I can get something at McDonald's and eat something. If that price starts going up, bad things are going to happen. Yeah, French Revolution being the other really good example of this. The cost of bread is one of those things that's always really hard to illustrate for students because it doesn't quite go in. Yeah, the cake quote is almost certainly fake, but it does do a good job of demonstrating. So cake quote, obviously being Marie Antoinette let them eat cake when she heard that there was no bread. But it does demonstrate the level of disconnect between nobility and peasantry. If you have bread, it's what you can eat. It's the dollar. It's the dollar menu of back then. If I have that, I can eat it. So in Russia, the cost is going up because it's a war and costs go up in war, and rationing is not working out. That's interesting. I'll have to look into that because I've only ever heard people saying it was Marie Antoinette and disproving it. The reason that I really like the quote, even if it is completely fake, I'll have to look into that, son of Matthias. The thing that you have to know about Marie Antoinette, you know, diversion tactic, Marie Antoinette in the Palace of Versailles, she had a fake farmer's cottage that her and her friends would go to and basically play dress up. The modern day equivalent of this would be if at the White House, Donald Trump had a fake Starbucks that he went into and pretended to be a Starbucks barista. So Marie Antoinette, I'm forgetting the name of it. It's still there. You can visit it when you go to the Palace of Versailles. She had a little fake farm set up that she could go and pretend to be like a farmer's wife with her friends. So very, very disconnected. So the women are protesting rationing and the rising cost of bread. They're not able to feed their families. This is people going to the streets going, we have no food. We have no food. Nothing is working. They're also protesting poor working conditions. Because again, Russia's an autocracy. Unions are starting to be a thing. They're not quite a thing at this point in history. You've got more like trade guilds and stuff like that. But in Russia, there's no protection. So they're protesting the fact that they have no food, that food is really expensive, and they're protesting the poor working conditions, and just everything's coming to a head. Previously, there had been a peaceful protest called Bloody Sunday, which had been a priest had led a group of people to protest outside the Tsar's palace, and they'd been gunned down. So that had not been good for the Tsar. So when the women come out to protest the lack of bread and the rising prices, the soldiers are called out, but they're tired too. Russia's version of the Pinkerton men was pretty much the soldiers. They just straight up used the they just would use the military. But at this point, so there's a protest of all these women coming asking for, you know, bread and better working conditions. The people in charge call out the soldiers, but the soldiers go, you know what? Screw this. So the soldiers join the protests. Specifically, the soldiers are tired of years of a poorly led war. You have to remember, one of the reasons why World War I sucked so much, there's many reasons, but one of the reasons why World War I sucked so much is that the people in control, the generals and all that, were nobility. So, you know, Nicholas, Tsar Nicholas, had gone to the front. He didn't know anything about battle. So, you know, you've got a war being led by people who have control because of their last name, not because they actually know anything about battle. So soldiers are pissed off because years of a poorly led war, the Tsar had left his wife in charge of St. Petersburg, and they thought that was stupid. So the soldiers joined the protesters. So the point where the Russian Revolution really gets going is when the soldiers join you. That's really the point in any revolution where you know things are going bad, is when you call in the military and they join the protesters, or you call in the police and they join the protesters. That's when you want to like start packing your bags and get the hell out of Dodge. And they have various other demands, but the one thing that unites them is they don't want the Tsar. They're like, no, we don't want any more Tsar. We have identified the Tsar as the cause of the problems. And in many cases, he was. Again, when you have the Tsar running everything in this autocracy, there's not a whole lot that you can do. So massive, massive protests happening. This is outside the palace in St. Petersburg. Massive protests. Soldiers are joining in. So here we have, you know, the protesters around them and the soldiers coming in. The other bad thing about soldiers joining a protest is usually they join the protest after they've already gotten guns and stuff. So they're now bringing guns to a protest. Tsar Nicholas resisted and sort of tried to make things stop for 8 days, but then he realized this was not going well. So Tsar Nicholas II actually abdicates and gives up the throne. So, you know, Romanov dynasty ended in Russia. Tsar's abdication followed by Michael's constitutional assembly to be convoked. Because when Nicholas gave up the throne, he didn't go, there is no more Tsar. He went, I give up the throne and I give it to my brother. I want him to be the Tsar. His brother very wisely went, no. His brother was like, no, you're not giving me this. I'm getting the hell out of Dodge. So when Tsar Nicholas abdicated, it essentially ended at that moment 300 years of the Romanov family ruling Russia, and centuries before that of autocracy. So there's going to be some, you know, fallout, but this is the moment where there's no more Russian nobility, essentially. When Tsar Nicholas abdicates, he doesn't entirely abdicate. He kind of half does it because they set up a temporary government. The provisional government, provisional meaning temporary, was intended to be around just long enough for elections. So it's not intended to run the government long term. It's we need someone to run the show while we figure out, you know, while we write a constitution, while we do this, while we do that. So provisional government, the problem is that the provisional government is mostly appointed by the Tsar. And this is very obvious. So the protesters go, yay, we got rid of the Tsar, but his buddies are still running Russia. Provisional government knows that they need to make friends with the people fast. So the first thing they do is they want to make Russia a republic with an elected legislator. So similar to what we have, you know, you vote for someone, they represent you. You know, it's not going to be, it wouldn't have been identical to the American system, but that's what I'm talking about. You elect someone, they represent you in Congress or some version of that. They decided to get rid of the death penalty because Russia's famously harsh, so like they're not going to kill anyone anymore. They're going to create universal suffrage voting. Prior to this, there had been some limited voting among the nobility. This is specifically extending it to the common man. I don't remember if it included women in that. I can't remember if women were included in that universal suffrage or if it was universal male suffrage. Again, this is a point in time where, you know, women don't have a vote in the United States. Around this time, they'd gotten the vote in England, because I remember that England gave women the vote before America, but I don't remember how the time difference between that. So the provisional government is trying to be nice. They're trying to make people friendly. The problem is, they're incredibly unpopular. They're incredibly unpopular because they didn't stop World War I. That's like the big one. I think the provisional government might have been able to last, and we may not have had communism in Russia if they had just yoinked themselves out of World War I. But they don't. Eventually, Russia will get out of World War I early, but at this point, Russia's still fighting in the war. They also didn't give the peasants land. A lot of people wanted there to be more land that was given to them. They didn't give city workers control of the factories. Both of these are linked to the growing communism in Russia. So communism had been growing very popular in Russia. There was a significant push for the provisional government to go kind of semi-communist, I guess would be the way I'd put it, and they didn't do that. They also eventually reestablished the death penalty for soldiers who deserted. So if you're fighting on the front lines and you run away, you can get killed. So they kind of half-heartedly tried to make people like them. They could have done more. They had some good reasons, like the good reason for not getting out of World War I is if you're trying to leave a war early, you want to do so very, very carefully because otherwise you're the next person invaded. So this is where we start seeing communism take hold. It had gone back a while. So communism had been kind of rising in Russia for a long time. You can definitely look more into the, I don't cover it very much in my slides, it'll be kind of a quick approach. Usually later on in the year, we'll go back and look more in depth at communism when we get to like Cold War lessons. In 1905, groups called the Soviets, Workers' Councils, formed to represent the working class. At that point when they formed, they were a little bit more like kind of what we would think of as unions. So they're representing farmers, factory workers, soldiers. And originally, Soviets were not communist. Yeah, communist. Yeah, then there's a whole thing that can be said about has there ever actually been real communism and communism on paper versus communism in practice versus communism in the USSR. We're not, I don't think we really get into that. I try to get into that with students, but it's always really difficult to get into because, to be completely frank, I don't know it as much as I should. I should know more about communism and all the fiddly bits that I actually do, off the top of my head at least. So originally Soviets were not communists. They were just, again, kind of like unions. So they're just kind of representing the working class. But they begin to embrace Bolsheviks and they begin to embrace communism. And yes, I do have students who do not know what the heck communism is. So I give them my little description of a system where all property is public. People work according to their ability and are given things by the government according to their needs. And I do break it down. And yeah, I do. So if you have a government, you are not having communism. Yeah, definitely the very quick sort of, you know, again, history, high school history level approach to that is true communism. This is my understanding. I know my understanding is a little flawed, but true communism can only exist if everything is communist. So a lot of kind of communism as we think of it, thanks to the USSR, is due to the fact that in order to make communism work in one country, stuff had to be done. And I'll usually have like activities where I sort of explain what the hell communism is, how it's supposed to work, etc. But I kind of gloss over those. I figure you guys know at least as much as me about communism. Yeah, you don't, you get, well, a lot of the California, at least that I've, the way that I've taught communism in class has been more focused on communism as it relates to history. So we sort of gloss over it at this point, usually in lessons, and then we'll go into it in a little bit more detail when we talk about the Cold War. But again, a lot of times when we're talking about communism, we're talking about communism as it manifests in the USSR, as opposed to the theories of communism and stuff like that. So very quickly, the communists, specifically under Lenin, get involved in this. And the communists overthrow the provisional government. So provisional government had only intended to be around long enough to get a real government set up. They are overthrown. So on the 25th of October, Lenin issues this declaration. To the citizens of Russia, the provisional government has been deposed. Government authority has passed into the hands of an organ of the Petrograd Soviet of Workers' and Soldiers' Deputies, the Military Revolutionary Committee, which stands at the head of the Petrograd Proletariat Garrison. The task for which the people have been struggling, the immediate offer of a democratic peace, the abolition of landlord property and land, worker control over production, the creation of a Soviet government, this task is assured. Long live the revolution of workers, soldiers, and peasants. Essentially, Lenin was in a good position and actually got help from the Germans to get back to Russia, because the Germans went, hey, if we get Russia out of the war, our life is going to be a lot easier. They still ended up losing, but they were right about that. So Lenin comes in and helps sort of sweep things, get things under control. And in that little first declaratory speech he gave, he outlined the four things that Bolsheviks needed to do. They needed to end the war, because they knew the war was wildly unpopular. They're going to get rid of private ownership and property, because communism. They're going to give workers control of the factories, again, communism. And they're going to create a new Soviet government. So they're going to create an actual democratic government. Under Lenin, things were not as bad as they'd eventually get. And you have to remember that this is a country that did not have anything approaching a democratic government before. So in the scheme of things, they're more democratic than the czars. You know, that's not saying much, but it is more democratic than the czars. And they're going to be sweeping out the old and getting the new. The provisional government went no. So partially the demise of the provisional government is, part of it is Lenin was trying to get rid of it, and the communists were trying to get rid of it. And part of it, the provisional government were like, we're not going to work with you. They were also joined by other educated elites. And this results in, basically, I'm going to summarize this a little bit as Russian Civil War. Russian Civil War breaks out. I'm kind of glossing over some of this, but that you have the Red Guard, the Red Army under Lenin and the communists, versus the White Guard under various people. And the White Guard were kind of loosely united in the fact that they did not want to be communist. So Lenin's all there going peace, land, and bread. That's what he's promising the people of Russia. Which is a heck of a promise, because it's nice and snappy. You know, he's going to focus on giving land. Again, I'm going to do a little bit of brushing, because a lot of this is fairly simple. So he does abolish private property. All land, factories, everything now belongs to the state. They are going to distribute farmland to the peasants. They give factories to the workers to control. Later on, they will start to institute more controls over this, so that it is, you know, yeah, the land belongs to everyone, but the government dictates what you do. But in the immediate aftermath of the Lenin Soviets taking control, things get better in Russia. Wages go up. The workday is shortened. They're abolishing the class system. There's no more nobility. The nobles either flee Russia or get turned into peasants real quick. This also helps him fill the bread promise. Because now that he's got all these people working land, some of the land which hadn't previously been worked or was not being worked. If you own the land, again, they're not really owning the land, but if you have some control over the land you're working, you're more likely going to be more invested in it. peasants were more willing to work on land that they owned. Again, they didn't really own it, but they felt more like they owned it. So there's more bread being produced. Factory workers who had been striking go back to work because they're getting the things they'd asked for, you know, safety stuff, higher raises, higher rates of pay. And for peace, he gets them out of World War I. Specifically, in March of 1918, Russia and Germany/Central Powers sign the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, which is signed by Russia and Germany. Russia surrenders land to the Central Powers in exchange for getting out of the war. This is the land that they surrender. Go back. So all of this land in this orange and sort of greenish color had been part of Russia. They give this chunk to Germany, this chunk to Austria-Hungary. Since the World War I ends fairly soon after that, it doesn't remain in the control of either for long. Was it actual workable land? To my knowledge, yes. It was actual workable land. So talking about the land that the Soviets gave to the that the Soviets gave to the peasants. What it is that they're doing is that it was the land had been owned by nobles or landlords. And it's more they're going, you know, chunk, let's chop it up and give it to individuals. So you have an increase, and probably also some of the land may have been, like, not farmed before. But the increase would have been due to probably a monetary would have had an impact on it. In that, if I'm working on land that someone else owns, I'll get, you know, a wage of some sort. And while my wage might be tied to how productive the land is, it's not completely tied. So, like, the sort of comparison I would make for this is, you know, one of the various, you know, summer jobs I had at one point is I was a cashier at a Home Depot. And as part of being a cashier at the Home Depot, they wanted me to sell, like, extended warranties, you know, protection plans, etc. And those were always annoying to sell because no one really wants one and they're annoying. I was never very motivated to sell them because while my boss would go, hey, you didn't sell these, I didn't really get any bonus for selling them. If I, on the other hand, owned my own hardware store, where if I sold that warranty, I got that money, I'd be more motivated. So I think some of the production, the increase in production of bread, again, using bread just to indicate food in general, would have been due to investment of the person. And also some of it probably also had to do with this. Whereas, again, a reminder that World War I's going on, so a lot of the people who would be working the fields usually are off fighting. They end the war, they're able to raise that back up. So Russia gets out of World War I. Russia leaves World War I early, and that has a whole bunch of, you know, connotations that last down the road. But all things considered, they don't lose that much. This is a fair amount of land. More important than that, this is a fair amount of land that is occupied. Whenever you're looking at a map of Russia, you want to kind of remember that the closer you get to the rest of Europe, the more stuff there is there. The farther you get away, like, you know, out in Siberia, not a whole lot of stuff. So that is a fair, like, loss of population and stuff. But it was the loss of population, the loss of land that had been added to Russia fairly later on. So he has gotten everything. And it's around this point that stuff starts turning a bit bleak. USSR goes dark very early. It's not long at all after Lenin takes control, after the USSR starts to become a thing, that they start going, you know, peace, land, and bread no matter what. Lenin's actions, unsurprisingly, were not always for the good of the people. He started taking harsh measures to stay in power. One big reason is that running a government costs money. Everything costs money, but running a government costs money. So, you know, you need to get taxes and stuff. Another big reason why Lenin starts kind of going dark, as I put it, not everyone surrendered to the Bolsheviks. Again, there was a civil war going on. The Russian Civil War, which is something that really rarely gets focused on, but America helped. America sent, like, supplies to the whites. I'm not going to play this because I don't want to get a strike, but this is where we're going to do a little bit of a transition to, the rumor in St. Petersburg. So I think most of us have seen the Anastasia movie, which, yes, is ridiculously not true. Like, you could make an art... I almost think the movie would have been better if they'd been a little bit more true to the story of how the heck people died. So we're going to take this diversion to look at the last... we're going to sort of come... There's like two more things we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about the last of the Tsars, so Anastasia and her family. And we're going to talk about Lenin a little bit more. And that'll be the end of what we're going to do today. We still got some time. So there's a civil war going on. On one side, communists. Under the Red Banner, so the Red Army. On the other side, everybody else, the White Army. So, specifically, White Army is anti-Bolshevik. There's a few different organizations. Some of them just don't like communism. Some of them don't like everything. Lenin identifies Kulaks and White Army as the enemies. So these are the two groups that Lenin is saying are the enemies of communist Russia. So the Kulaks are peasants who own a large amount of land. They're kind of middle classes, you know. They're not nobility, but they're middle class. And he identifies them as the bad guys. He says it's pretty much he's saying landlords are bad guys. So that's what the Kulaks are. Is he says these are bad. They're the most beastly, the coarsest, the most savage exploiters. He said they'd gotten rich during the war at expense of workers. So communism had already destroyed the monarchy. This is them going even further and destroying like. I don't even think this would be upper middle class. I think this would just be like middle class or even like lower middle class or like upper lower class if that was a thing. The other big enemy of Russia is the White Army. Excuse me. The White Army, again, there's a Russian civil war going on. The White Army is the non-communist side. A lot of them are proponents of the monarchy. So they want to restore the monarchy. A lot of them want to bring back landlords, and Lenin is saying that they're going to kill everybody. So everything on this slide right here is what Lenin is saying. I don't know if the word kulak has anything to do with the word gulag. I know it's a Russian word. I think it's a Russian word which doesn't have like a direct translation, but basically translates as like higher up peasants. If I'm remembering correctly. So again, it's they're still a peasant, but they own a little bit more. So like this would be like if everyone in your neighborhood rents, the kulak would be the person who owns their house. I think so. I think Menshevik is White Army. It's been a while since I go a little bit more into the Russian Civil War when I teach the class, because these slides that I put together are kind of combining a few days and pulling out some of the stuff. I think so. It's been a while since I looked at the Russian Civil War from a non-teaching it in a high school history class. So specifically, the thing that's going to have the most impact on history with regards to, or at least, you know, the simplified version of history, with regards to Lenin's thing, is that he believes, and in many cases was true, that the White Army wanted to restore the monarchy. So as I had said previously, Nicholas had abdicated the throne. He'd given up the throne. He was not technically the Tsar anymore. We still call him the Tsar just because he's the last Tsar of Russia, but he'd abdicated the throne. When he abdicated the throne, that was the signal for a lot of royals to flee Russia. And actually, both sides of World War I helped with that. Because you have to remember, this is a point where there's that great there's the great nobility of Europe. You know, when it comes to World War I, England, Germany, and Russia were all like first cousins. They're all cousins to each other. They're on different sides of the war, but they're all cousins to each other. So when it became clear that Russia was getting rid of their nobility, basically you just kind of went like, oh, you married a British nobility, you go to England. You married German nobility, go to Germany. So there was this mass exodus from Russia of nobility, of kind of all, even minor nobles. There's apparently was a joke where in the aftermath of the Russian Revolution, if you wanted to find Russian nobility, you would go to Paris, because apparently a bunch of Russian, like, minor nobles in Russia had fled to Paris and were now, and were, like, driving cabs. So, minor Russian nobility scattered to the winds and just kind of ended up everywhere. Like, if they could get out, they did get out. The Tsar and his immediate family, so the Tsar, his wife, his son, and then some of his, I think these are some of his daughters, and there's another one who I don't think is this picture. So, Tsar Nicholas, his wife, and their kids had the opportunity to leave. They had the chance to leave Russia, but they stayed. Some of this is due to the fact that they had been put under house arrest. The provisional government had put them under house arrest so that they couldn't go somewhere else and try and take control back. But, so that's one reason. One reason they didn't leave is they were being kept in one place so they wouldn't try and take control of Russia again. There's also some evidence that they might have thought things were going to turn out all right for them. There's some evidence that they might have thought that they would have, that the Tsar thought he'd end up in a situation like with England, where he was like more of a constitutional monarch. But in any case, there were opportunities where they could have left, but they stayed. And in August of 1917, Nicholas, his immediate family, and some of their assistants are sent into exile in Siberia. In April of 1918, the people holding, because they weren't just like sent off and left to do whatever, they were sent off and guarded. In April of 1918, the Bolsheviks, so Lenin's party, take control of them and they're moved even further east. So they're being moved around a fair amount to different places. They're being moved fairly often. Some of this is due to the fact that, again, Russian Civil War going on, so they're being moved away from battlefields. On July 17th of 1918, Nicholas and his family were told that they were going to be moved again. They're like, hey, we're going to move you again. Pack up all your stuff. Because they're not living like the life of luxury. They're, you know, being very sort of harshly looked after. When this happens, they believe that they're being moved because the White Army had advanced. So White Army being their side, the pro-monarchy guys. And they actually thought, hey, this means we'll be free soon. They didn't know if it meant, like, we're going to be free to flee Russia or we're going to be free to take back control, but they thought it was a good thing. They thought, oh, the White Army is coming to save us. Everything's going to be good once more. Things were not good once more. This is from a random movie I found that has a good...
Wow.
So this is our actor playing Tsar Nicholas and being told by the people keeping him that they're going to be leaving.
We're leaving. Don't be afraid. The White Army must have broken through. Help Anastasi.
And I believe this movie has been reconstructed with some of the written accounts of, you know, the soldiers involved and stuff. So there we have Alexei, so their one son. Again, he is hemophiliac. At this point, he had an issue with his leg. So his... His leg is in like a brace. Did the anti-monarchy pro-democracy side have any influence during this war, or were they observed by the whites? So I don't know as much about the White Army as I really want to. It's been a while since I studied them. My memory is that the White Army actually was a little bit hampered by the fact that they had conflicting. Because the White Army is basically made up of anyone who's anti-communist. So there were some people that would have been anti-monarchy but pro non-communist democracy, etc. So my memory is that there was kind of multiple factions going on, but I don't know to be honest. Most of my Russian history that I took in college was focused on, like, it ended with, like, it was focused on, like, the Romanovs themselves, and thus ended with, like, the stuff we're looking at right now, or was, you know, Cold War era communism. So I don't know specifically how much of a role anti-monarchy, pro-democracy played in the White Army. At this point, they're being kept in basically a big manor house. I think it had belonged to a member of the autocracy, but they're being kept in very lower conditions than they were expected. Again, Alexei had been injured, and so his father's carrying him. Red badge, even though you might immediately go to Nazi, because usually when we see a red arm badge, that's what it means. That just indicates that that's a communist, communist party member, basically. Communist party was not that, at least to my knowledge, was not that, like, specifically structured during this time, but this is one of those cases where red equals communism, not Nazis.
Wait in here, please.
So this clip from this movie, or it might be a mini-series, I can't remember specifically, does not go into it, but there is some accounts that they were perhaps told they were going to have a picture taken for propaganda purposes. There had been various accusations of, like, hey, are the Romanovs dead? Do you actually have control of them? So there's some stuff to indicate that they were maybe told, we're going to move you after we take a photo to be like, hey, you're still alive. This dude here is their doctor, I believe. They had a few members of, like, their household with them, like, kind of maids, specifically doctor. I think the Tsar also had, like, his butler who'd gone into this, this situation with them. And some of this, you know, definitely a question that arises is why aren't they more freaked out? Why are they kind of calm? Which, by indications, they were calm. Again, Europe at this point is a giant noble family. So I think in some point they were most likely kind of soothed, not as worried, because they thought, oh, if they do anything to us, the rest of Europe is going to forget, you know, is going to come to help us. So that might account for some of the why they didn't leave, why they didn't try and flee more like this. They'd been relatively unharmed during a fairly lengthy period of imprisonment, but that was all going to come to an end. So yes, execution by firing squad is the sad truth of the Romanov family. So July 17th, 1918, the royal family is executed. Tsar, his wife, their kids, the doctor, and I think one other was killed as well. The sort of even worse part of this, the Tsar, the prince, and their attendants, so the doctor and the maids and stuff, they died quickly. The Tsarina, the Tsar's wife, and the princesses, including Princess Anastasia, did not. The reason for this difference? The royal women had sewn jewels into their clothing in order to hide them. They had had jewels taken from them. You know, jewels are an easy source of money. As I mentioned earlier, they thought they were maybe going to escape. Those jewels would have been what they would have lived off of. So they'd sewn jewels into kind of like their undergarments, especially. And those jewels acted almost like bulletproof vests. So not good bulletproof vests, but like semi-bulletproof vests. So when they were shot, they did not die immediately from, you know, massive barrage of gunfire. There's actually accounts that read that they had to be bayoneted to kill them, so stabbed to death. How we know this? Eventually the people involved sort of came out. The reason that the the Anastasia story lasted for such the amount of time that it does and even has people believing it today, is that for a long time, the Bolsheviks didn't admit this. The Bolsheviks spent years sort of going, oh yeah, the family's still alive, we're holding them somewhere. Or they'd say, oh, we didn't kill them, someone else did. They sort of flip-flopped all around. The bodies of the Romanovs were hidden and moved several times over the years. But this gives rise to the rumor that Anastasia specifically had survived. It's interesting. I still kind of have not gotten a good reason for why it's Anastasia that's the one. So Anastasia, you know, going back, Anastasia had several sisters. She was the youngest girl. Her brother was younger than her, but she was the youngest girl. And for some reason, when rumors circulated that one of the Romanovs had survived, there were a few different rumors at the beginning. Some of the early rumors actually had it be a different princess that had survived. But for some reason, Anastasia is the most popular choice for the survivor. Multiple people have made, or at least tried to make a living by claiming to be Anastasia. But the fact of the matter is, she died with her family. In 1979, the bodies were found and sort of brought to light finally. Again, they'd been moved before, but this is the point where the bodies are brought out as, yeah, these are the bodies. So the bodies were located, but the grave was not really touched until 1989. At which point samples were taken, DNA was run, and it confirmed that these are the Romanovs. So the Romanovs were actually reburied with a full-on funeral in 1998. And they're actually seen as something of some elements of the Russian Orthodox Church actually identify them as saints. It's, you know, a little halo indicates sainthood of them. They're seen as martyrs for the cause. This is actually from when they were excavated. So these are the bodies of some of the Romanovs, the skeletal remains. As I said, they were killed. They were killed in order to keep the White Army from having a threat. Because while there was other nobility, that line of father to son for the Romanovs was broken when they killed them. So, yeah. There was never a surviving princess. All the bodies have been found. They've been accounted for. They've been DNA tested to indicate that they are who we thought they were. So the last thing I'm going to go over for this is a little bit of Lenin to what came afterwards. So here we have sort of the big names in the USSR. We got Lenin, we got Stalin, and we got Trotsky. So obviously Lenin was the guy in charge when Russia was first going communist. He had hoped that the October Revolution, the February Revolution, the revolutions of Russia would inspire workers outside of Russia to revolt. So Lenin had this kind of great idea that once Russia did it, everyone else would follow. That didn't happen. I don't think that's a surprise to anyone that it didn't happen. And while he set about trying to help guide Russia so that communism would work in one state, he was not in the best of health. In 1923, Lenin suffered a series of strokes. He suffered several strokes. He survived. Why does Trotsky look like a hipster uncle? Oh, just wait until I think this slide has the picture of Stalin that's insane. So Lenin suffered several strokes. He survived them, but he could no longer lead the USSR. So he was in very bad health. This is a photo from more toward the end of his life. He was alive, he could communicate, but he was in no condition to lead the USSR. So there starts to be this question of who is going to be the next leader of the USSR. So again, they all look kind of hipstery. Like I imagine that if I went to if COVID wasn't a thing right now and I went to a cafe, I could find people wearing all of this. Gorbachev is much later. Gorbachev's much, much later. This is, I don't even know. I think Gorbachev wouldn't even have been born yet. I don't know. I can't remember the time specifically. So Lenin is now looking very creepy in a wheelchair. Like, that's how you know the strokes have gotten to you, when that's, like, a photo that they actually published. So, Lenin is not in good health. It very quickly becomes apparent that either Stalin or Trotsky is going to be the next leader of the USSR. So, let's look at the two. There are so many creepy photos from this time. Like, this one, for some reason, very much unsettles me. I do not feel safe with Trotsky's eyes upon me. Trotsky was Lenin's first choice. Was Lenin's friend. Lenin wanted Trotsky to be the next leader of the USSR. I meant Gorbachev. I don't think he was alive at this point. Because I'm a little surprised he's still alive, but I don't think he would have been born at this point, which is what I was saying about Mikhail Gorbachev. Trotsky was, again, so Lenin's friend. Lenin wants Trotsky, the one to take his place. Trotsky was a war hero. He had helped found the Red Guard. He'd led the Red Army during the Russian Civil War. He was well known. He was popular. He was this war hero and this writer and speaker. So he was like the obvious choice for the job. He and Lenin were both focused on spreading communism. So Lenin and Trotsky both wanted communism to be not just a Russia thing. They wanted other countries to join. And specifically, Trotsky called for what he called permanent revolution. He said, we must always be in revolution. We must always be spreading communism. On the other hand, Stalin, the man of steel, he was quiet. He was not as well known. He was the general secretary of the USSR at this point, but that was a position that had not intended to be powerful. General secretary of the USSR was not an important position until Stalin made it important. He ended up being in a position where he decided who was and was not a member of the Communist Party. And in order to be anyone in Russia, you needed to be a member of the Communist Party. So he gets to say who's communist and who's not. He also wrangled things so that he could get important positions to his supporters. And he believed that the USSR should focus on itself instead of on spreading communism. So Lenin and Trotsky are saying we need to spread communism. Stalin is saying we need to build up Russia. He specifically calls for socialism in one state and wants to rapidly industrialize the USSR. So USSR is still not at like a factory production. So industrialized factory. Russia had been behind the rest of the world. Russia was still behind the rest of the world. Stalin wants to fix that. Specifically because he thinks that there's going to be wars in the future and that he wants to make sure that Russia can't be beaten. Oh, this is the image. Look at young Stalin. Isn't that like the most photogenic dude ever? Like how did that become that? But yeah, this is a young Stalin. This is like Stalin right when he first got involved in the Communist Party. It always gets, whenever I show that to students, it always gets a big reaction from mostly the girls, but sometimes the boys as well. You got this war going on, not like full-scale war, but there's this shuffling of power. Stalin manages to take control of the USSR with two others after Lenin has his third series of strokes. Stalin kind of arranges things to cut Trotsky out, and he puts a lot of his focus on keeping Trotsky out of power. Lenin dissed Stalin in a letter. There's actually this really great letter you can find where Lenin basically said, like, if you let this guy take control of the party, we're all doomed. But Stalin was in a position where he could censor the letter. So when Lenin eventually dies, Stalin slowly gains more and more power until by 1928, he's in complete control. In 1929, he exiles Trotsky, and Trotsky is eventually assassinated in Mexico in 1940 on the orders of Stalin with an axe, or sometimes I've seen it as an ice pick. So Stalin kind of was making the moves, was being sneaky, was taking control. One example of how Stalin, from the very beginning, was willing to do whatever he thought was necessary is on the 21st of January, 1924, Lenin dies. So 21st January, 1924, Lenin dies. When Lenin is dead, his body is embalmed because they want to have him on display. Like we do with presidents, you know, we put presidents on display. They wanted to do the same thing for Lenin. His body was embalmed to preserve it for long-term display. His wife protested because Stalin was saying, hey, we want to have him on display for a long time. We want to have, like, a monument. And Lenin's wife said, no, he wanted to be buried with his mom. Lenin had left very specific requests that after his death, he wanted to be buried in this specific cemetery, which was where his mother was buried. He wanted to be buried beside his mother. So his wife goes, no, my husband didn't want this. My husband wanted to be buried here normally. Lenin's wife, Stalin comes to her, and Stalin says, hey, if you don't shut up, I will let it be known that before his death, Lenin divorced you and married another. So Stalin says, if you don't shut up, I'm going to make a fake Lenin widow so that we can do this. And as you probably know, Lenin's body is still on display. You go to Moscow and you go to this tomb. You can go in and you can glimpse the terrifying Frankenstein project that is Lenin's body still lying there after all these years waiting for the eventual zombie apocalypse that will bring him back to life. Yeah. I used to have this really great clip that was just like a slow zoom in on Lenin's face as like this sort of, you know, Russian music played in the background, but I lost it. I will recommend, so Ask a Mortician. I'm not going to play this just because I want her to have all the view counts that she can get. Not that she needs to get all the subscribers, but let me drop that in the chat if my thing will let me. Computer, why? Link there, and I'll drop it in the chat in a second. She's got a really great video on how Lenin's corpse is a crazy Frankenstein project. So my chat's being annoying on my net. It's not letting me drop it in. Oh, wait. Nope. Yeah, it does feel unnatural in every way. And a warning. So again, it's on the screen there is the link to this video. Highly recommend it because she goes into a lot of interesting things about how they preserve it. A warning, there's moments in this video where you get to see what is underneath Lenin's suit. And it's terrifying. It really sets me off. But highly recommend this. Her channel's amazing. Especially important if you are transgender / know anyone who is transgender who is concerned about their wishes being followed in death. So if you know anyone who is concerned that after they die, they're going to be misgendered, on her channel, she has a video and she has links to some documents that at least in the United States you can use to try and ensure that that does not happen. So yeah, Lenin's corpse still on display after all these years, still as terrifying. What's interesting is that I don't have any slides about it, and I'm going a little bit off the top of my head of what I can remember, but Lenin's corpse, you know, it's still there, obviously. I've seen various arguments about whether or not they're going to eventually bury it. I think they will eventually, just because it costs like an insane amount of money to keep his corpse looking like that. For a while, Lenin's corpse was actually kind of used as this bargaining chip among communist countries. Specifically, I know that I think at one point China had been wanting to preserve Mao in a similar circumstance, but at that point, like, the relationship between China and Russia had degraded to a point that it didn't happen. There's some other communist dictator of an Asian country, not China, one of the smaller ones. I'm blanking on who it is, but they essentially got, like knockoff Lenin preservation materials and stuff. I think North Korea has gotten some, like, they got some assistance from the Lenin preservation team. But, the thing that really strikes me about Lenin's death is just that moment of Stalin going, we're going to find a better widow if you won't do your job. So, with that, we had our two, it might be Laos. It's been a while. I read about it a while back. I think it's one of those that, like, it worked for a while, and then when they actually overthrew communism, it might have been. I can't remember. I'd have to go deep diving. That they'd, my memory of it is that they had gotten, like, some assistance from the USSR. Like, they'd gotten info, but then, like, they couldn't keep it up. Or when they overthrew communism, got rid of communism, they just decided to you know, lose the body, etc. So with that, thank you guys very much for coming to Social Science Sunday. Right now I'm inclined to say that I'll probably do this again next Sunday. Maybe at some point I'll get before that. A lot of it depends on, as I mentioned at the start of the stream, I am a credentialed California history teacher. I'm currently unemployed / looking for a job, kind of looking like due to COVID and due to all this other stuff, I won't have a job this year. So I'll be moving at some point, that I've been lucky and that my father is willing to help me out. So, some of it depends on, I could theoretically be moving, you know, if I'm moving, then that. So current semi-plan is to try and do this a little more, is do this maybe at least every Sunday, maybe do it more, mostly just for fun times because I like talking about history. Before I go away, let me see if I can get you a cat. Mythos! Mr. Kitty Cat! I'm going to see if I can get you cat pics to end out the day, but I don't know where the cat is. Let's see if I can bring him running. Mythos, do you want to say hi to people? I'm shaking the treats. Baby! Where are you? I don't have that big of an apartment. How can you be hiding? Sorry guys, tried to get a cat for you, but apparently it's hot enough that he's decided that he's not gonna be coming out. So maybe that's for future streams. Well, I'm gonna try one more time. Mythos! Mythos! Yeah, no, sorry, no cat. Cat has decided that it's too hot, and I think he's hiding in my closet somewhere. So thank you guys very much. Hope to see you guys sometime in the future. Ways to know, I'll announce again on the various methods that I use this time when I'm going to be streaming. Also, if you go to Google Classroom and put in that little join code or go to History Scribe, I'll also announce on there, and of course I'll have